एवरीवन, आई एम मोहम्मद तबारक अंसारी, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इंग्लिश, केएमडी कॉलेज परबत्ता, विच इज अ कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट यूनिट ऑफ मुंगेर यूनिवर्सिटी मुंगेर बिहार, इज ऑर्गेनाइजिंग। इट्स माय इमेंस प्लेजर टू इंट्रोड्यूस ऑल ऑफ यू दैट द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ फिजिक्स, केएमडी कॉलेज परबत्ता, विच इज अ कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट यूनिट ऑफ मुंगेर यूनिवर्सिटी मुंगेर बिहार, इज ऑर्गेनाइजिंग अ वेबिनार on the topic of fundamentals of nanoscience and nanotechnology at the platform of Google Meet, and at the same time it will be live on YouTube channel today. This program will go on from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. I welcome and give thanks on the behalf of organizing committee of this webinar to all the participants who have been connected with us for this webinar from all over India. For the proceedings, I would like to invite Professor Shiv Kumar Agarwal, the principal of this college, for the welcome speech. Agarwal sir.
Namaskar. आज हमारे महाविद्यालय में हर्ष का विषय है कि महाविद्यालय के भौतिकी विभाग के द्वारा फंडामेंटल ऑफ नैनो साइंस एंड नैनो टेक्नोलॉजी विषय पर एक वेबिनार का आयोजन किया जा रहा है। आज जबकि संपूर्ण शैक्षणिक गतिविधियां ऑनलाइन संचालित हो रही है, हमारे महाविद्यालय में यह वेबिनार का चौथा आयोजन है। इसके पूर्व भी भौतिकी विभाग के द्वारा ऑनलाइन क्यूज का भी आयोजन किया गया था। इस वेबिनार से जुड़ने के लिए भारत के विभिन्न प्रदेशों से लगभग 860 प्रतिभागियों ने रजिस्ट्रेशन कराया है। इतनी बड़ी संख्या में प्रतिभागियों को देखते हुए गूगल मीट प्लेटफॉर्म पर सिर्फ 250 प्रतिभागी ही जुड़ सकते हैं। अन्य प्रतिभागियों को YouTube लाइव पर जोड़ने का प्रबंध किया गया है। मैं दोनों प्लेटफॉर्म से जुड़ने वाले सभी प्रतिभागियों का केएमडी महाविद्यालय परबत्ता परिवार की ओर से स्वागत करता हूं। मैं स्वागत करता हूं इस वेबिनार के चीफ पेट्रॉन मुंगेर विश्वविद्यालय मुंगेर के माननीय कुलपति प्रोफेसर रंजीत कुमार वर्मा सर का। स्वागत है सर। मुख्य इसके अतिरिक्त मुख्य वक्ता के रूप में इस वेबिनार की बातों को रखने के लिए हमारे बीच मौजूद हैं भौतिकी विभाग तिलका मांझी भागलपुर विश्वविद्यालय के प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर कमल प्रसाद, जो पूर्व में आर्यभट्ट ज्ञान विश्वविद्यालय के सेंटर ऑफ नैनो साइंस और नैनो टेक्नोलॉजी के विभाग अध्यक्ष रह चुके हैं। मैं उनका हार्दिक स्वागत करता हूं। अन्य मुख्य वक्ता जो दो वक्ता हैं, इनमें तिलका मांझी भागलपुर के रसायन शास्त्र विभाग के डॉक्टर अनंत कांत झा का एवं केडीएस कॉलेज गोगड़ी के भौतिकी विभाग अध्यक्ष डॉक्टर के भार्गव का बहुत बहुत स्वागत करता हूं। मैं आशा ही नहीं बल्कि पूर्ण विश्वास के साथ कह सकता हूं, इस वेबिनार से जुड़ने वाले सभी प्रतिभागियों को यह वेबिनार इसके मूलभूत सिद्धांतों को समझाने में सहायक सिद्ध होगी।
थैंक यू सर।
एक बार मैं इस वेबिनार के सफल आयोजन की कामना करते हुए
सर
यस अग्रवाल सर हैज बीन डिस्कनेक्टेड फॉर
इट वाज नॉट ऑडिबल
फॉर सर हैज बीन डिस्कनेक्टेड
नहीं नहीं हम तो जुड़े हुए हैं।
हाँ हाँ यस ऑडिबल प्लीज गो ऑन।
ओके He has finished his speech.
Yeah.
He has finished his speech, Professor Tabarak Sahab.
Yeah, okay.
So,
thank you, Agarwal sir. Next, I invite Dr. Anshu Kumar Roy, Assistant Professor of Physics, KMD College, Parbatta, who is convener of this webinar, to introduce the theme of webinar.
Oh, someone is presenting. Lot of people are presenting, so it is creating disturbances. Good morning. Thank you, Professor Tabarak. 1 minute. Very good morning to one and all. First of all, I would like to extend very warm welcome to all of you on behalf of organizing team of this webinar. The topic of webinar is fundamentals of nanoscience and nanotechnology. Nanoscience and nanotechnology has the potential to reshape the world around us. So research interest in this field has increased tremendously during last 2 decades. A lot of webinars and e-conferences are also being held in all over India nowadays, but none of them or very few are concentrating on fundamentals of this subject. So it becomes necessary for faculty members, research scholars, and students of physics, chemistry, biology, material science, and engineering to understand the basics or fundamental of nanoscience and nanotechnology. Keeping these points in our mind, we have selected the topic of webinar as fundamentals of nanoscience and nanotechnology. Nanoscience is the study of nanomaterials and its properties, while nanotechnology is using these materials and its properties to create something new or different. In my definition of nanoscience and nanotechnology, I have used the word nanomaterials. So what the nanomaterials are? Nanomaterials are the materials which possesses particles of the size ranging from 1 nanometer to 100 nanometer. As we most of us know that 1 nanometer is equal to 10 to the power minus 9 meter, that is 1 billionth part of a meter. If we want to visualize more about nano, then consider a human hair and divide it or thin it in roughly 50,000 to 1 lakh parts, then each part will be equal to 1 nanometer. So nanomaterials so different types of physical and chemical properties. Let us consider a gold lump. As we all know that gold is yellow in color in a bulk state, but once we go once we divide it, it will change its color. It changes its color to reddish. May also sometimes appear as green, orange, or purple, depending upon the size and shape of the nano-sized particles. So what we observe is that physical property, color, which is a physical property, is changing at the nano level. Similarly, we also know that gold is chemically inactive in the bulk macro or micro level. But again, if we go to nano level, then we see that gold acts as a catalyst. So chemical property is changing at the nano level. This is quite amazing and interesting too, that while we are not changing the chemical composition or crystal structure of the substance, but physical property and chemical property is changing. So what is the reason, of this? You will find the answers to such questions in the invited, in the keynote speech of Dr. Kamal Prasad. He is with us. His speech is on why nano behaves differently, just after the inaugural speech of our Honorable Vice Chancellor. He will talk. And after Dr. Kamal Prasad, Dr. Anil Kant Jha will be talking on the topic of nanoscience and living systems, promises and its limitations. At the end, Dr. K.K. Bhargav will be dealing with some special type of nanomaterials having gas sensing and multifunctional properties. So with the view of some fruitful discussion during the webinar, I once again welcome you all with the core of my heart. Thank you. Thank you all. Professor Tawarak. Professor Tawarak, are you there? Professor Tawarak.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, Anshu, sir.
Professor Tawarak.
Yes, yes.
So, Professor Tawarak is not there. So.
Yeah. I am.
Yes, here, yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Once again, I would like to invite Dr.
Yes, yes, you are audible.
Anshu Kumar Roy. Once again, I would like to invite Dr. Anshu Kumar Roy to introduce VC sir to the participants. Okay, over to you, Anshu sir.
Thank you, Professor Tawarak sahab. Now we will have inaugural speech of our Honorable VC sir. So I am just presenting his brief biodata before all the participants. Professor Ranjit Kumar Verma is an internationally acclaimed figure in the field of thermal chemistry. His name figures in the list of 350 world's leading thermal scientists published in the second edition of Who is Who in Thermal Analysis by Springer Science from Europe. He holds various posts in reputed scientific bodies and organizations. He is a member of the editorial board of globally prestigious Journal of Thermal Analysis and Calorimetry. He is treasurer of Indian Science Congress Association, vice president of Indian Council of Chemists, vice president of the Indian Thermal Analysis Society, fellow of Institution of Chemists, secretary of International Confederation for Thermal Analysis and Calorimetry, and also convener of Bihar Science Academy. His research interests are in thermal analysis, particularly its application in solid state kinetics and preparation of nanoparticles and finding their photoluminescence, magnetic and electrical properties. In 2017, he was invited in Budapest to deliver a special lecture on ferrite nanoparticles. He was also nominated as visitor in Nagaland Central University by President of India. He has served as CCVC of Magadha University, Bodh Gaya, and Pro Vice Chancellor of Patna University for one time. Presently, as a Vice Chancellor of newly created Munger University, he is making all his efforts to help Munger University excel. So now I request our Honorable VC sir to come on virtual dais and for inaugural speech. VC sir, please.
Thank you, Dr. Anshu Kumar Rai, for the nice words of introduction. And I really appreciate the style and the lucidity with which he introduced the wonderful subject of nanoscience and nanotechnology. एक मीटर का एक करोड़वां या एक अरबवां टुकड़ा इस दोनों के बीच के साइज को नैनो डायमेंशन में देखते हैं. He introduced it so beautifully with the example of the blue and the yellow gold and the property. So really, when any material, any substance, whether it is metal, metalloid or non-metal or a composite particle or any compound or any material, if it is in nano dimension, if it is in that size, its properties, not only physical, the color, just like you also mentioned it so nicely, that the color of gold, which is yellow as we see in the normal day-to-day life, it becomes the color changes. Not only the color, or not only the adsorption, which is crucial to finding application of nanosensor, and so not only these, but many chemical properties are also affected, and they are governed by the size of the phase and other things. So before going further, I congratulate all the persons who are associated with holding of this seminar under the stewardship of our dynamic principal of that college, and Agrawal Sahib, and all the friends, particularly he had been my co-author. We authored one paper, research paper, which was published in JTAC, Journal of Thermalysis and Calorimetry, Springer, which he was mentoring. Kamal, he was with us. So I know the work, the grand work that he's doing, and really I congratulate all the organizers to call him for a keynote address. I think he will be introducing it in a much effective way. The main problem of nanoscience and nanotechnology is the quantum of experimentation, the infrastructure that we require today. Nanotization, nanoscience, it becomes with the preparation of nanomaterials, materials which are nanosized, and then the problem of structural elucidation or the morphology or microscopy and the analysis of these properties are important. For all those things, we need sophisticated instruments which are costly. Their maintenance and the supporting staff, the technical personnel that we require, for example, if you have an SIM or if you have a TIM for that purpose, you will require the infrastructure, the laboratory, the support that it will be required there, and the person, the trained person who will be there, and then how to transfer the data, the pass on the data to these users. So starting from the preparation, synthesis of nanomaterials, to studying their structure, and to study their properties, electrical properties, magnetic properties, optical properties, or whatever property you decide. Unless you know the property, it is very difficult to find the applications. So all sort of properties, from thermal properties to electrical property to magnetic property, you know, these properties are so important. We know this is an era of tailor-made smart materials. Materials, which are being the besides having the structural property, the structural property, how do they react to an external stimuli? If you we used to study Le Chatelier principle in chemistry, and we used to remember how when equilibrium is set in, how a small change in the volume or pressure or any condition which is controlling the equilibrium, if it is affected, it is changed, a minor change, how the equilibrium is shifting. Le Chatelier was so interesting in understanding chemical equilibrium, wonderful. So in the same way, today we talk about smart materials, and smart materials have they for example, if it put it in magnetic field, how it changes its property, how does it behave in a magnetic field, how does it behave in an electric field, how does it behave in when it is exposed to radiation, photoluminescence, or other property, like that, so on and so forth. So the putting any material in any under any external stimuli, and then looking at its behavior, monitoring its behavior, is very crucial. Only then, thereafter, you can put it to use. And these introductory things, often we say, okay, the sword of that emperor, or the coin of that, the the coin minting, which was being iconography and numismatics, which was being taught in Nalanda University and Vikramshila University during ancient era, or the Udantpuri University, the three universities were burnt by Bakhtiar Khilji. So during that period, Pal period, and before that, the people were being taught coin minting, and they were sintering the material, the metal, the alloy in such a way that the coins that have been found of those era, which were minted in China and in India, and the minters were trained in Nalanda and these universities, people have found that nano coating is there. So they might not have been knowing what is nano. But the nano coating was there. I think I am getting you. Sound is going? Anshu, awaaz ja rahi hai? Anshu, awaaz ja rahi hai meri?
Yes, sir. Aapki awaaz aa rahi hai, sir.
Haan. So,
yes, sir. Your sound is too clear. Clear, okay. Sir. Aapki awaaz aa rahi hai, sir.
Thank you. So,
sir, aapki awaaz aa rahi hai.
हाँ, नैनोटाइजेशन के बारे में हम प्रोसेस जानते थे कि उससे स्टेबिलिटी आती है, अगर तलवार के ऊपर उसको करें या सिक्के के ऊपर करें, सिक्के की ढलाई, जिसकी ट्रेनिंग, जिसकी स्पेशल पढ़ाई विश्व में सबसे पहले नालंदा में शुरू हुई, विक्रमशिला में था, और हमारे उडंतपुरी में था, वो उस विश्वविद्यालय में जो सिक्के की ढलाई और सिक्के की सिक्का का विज्ञान जो प्राचीन भारतीय इतिहास वाले विद्यार्थी और सब पढ़ते हैं, लेकिन उस सिक्के यहाँ की पढ़ाई करने के बाद अलग अलग देशों में, चीन में या भारत में या जापान या कोरिया में कहाँ कहाँ लोग गए, और सिक्के के बारे में वो सिक्का उस समय का मिलता है, उस पर नैनोटाइजेशन है, नैनो कोटिंग है. तो दे वेर नॉट एबल टू यूज द वर्ड, दे वेर नॉट, नो इंस्ट्रूमेंट फ्रॉम दोस टाइम, बट द नैनोटाइजेशन पीपल वी आर नोइंग इट. आई विल गिव वन मोर थिंग. We have been reading and we have been teaching those persons who are here from chemistry fraternity. I will, because we are going to enter into a phase of interdisciplinary studies. Aur abhi to Munger University mein hum log kai interdisciplinary hum plan bhi kiye hue hain. Anyway, in new education policy, we shall be going for it. Anyway, I am with for attention of my chemistry friends. Let me tell you, we have been teaching students phase rule, phase diagram. How many of us give emphasis on clear concept of phase and what happen if it is in nano dimension? So anything. So within, if any substance, any material in a single phase, the interaction, the chemical reaction will be convenient and more effective. So these are the things. So during introduction of phase rule itself, phase diagram itself, we can introduce nanotization and some idea. So there are many places. Whenever you are teaching any chapter in electricity or magnetic, my physics friends, for example, Kamal Babu, I think he will be able to appreciate it, that if you are going to introduce these things, you should also introduce that these properties alter, you should give example of nanomaterials, particularly a smart nanomaterial, so that students can get attracted, and they are get attracted to the literature. Ask them to go for literature survey. Even Google Scholar is freely available there, and so many resources are there. So just ask your students to write a review of 2,000 word, 1,000 word, and encourage them. Give your personal prize, 100 rupees, a certificate, personal certificate, that you can easily do. And edit that, help the student, and get it published at least in your journal or in your local newspaper. That way the student will be attracted towards science and technology and towards research, and that way we shall be getting good quality researcher, and then we will not be opposing and making SCI publication mandatory for those PhD, which we have been looking, we have been facing for the last 3 weeks or so on. Anyway, so I must congratulate you for looking for getting such an interesting topic at Parvatta is a nice place. I had visited, and the way with the commitment with which your earlier previous principal, even present principal, and all the teachers are doing, I really compliment and congratulate you. I wish this webinar a grand success. I wish I would have been on my system, because I had prepared a few slides to show you, which I am not able to show because it is my laptop is with me, but I may not be getting the connection may get lost. So I am using my phone to interact with you. So I think Kamal Babu and other persons are there. They will be doing the job. Also, so nicely introduced. I wish I could come someday to Parvata and to address to take some class, some small class of chemistry or physics student, or on having some lecture or giving some lecture on nanoscience if I find time in a physical in my physical appearance next day. Anyway, thank you very much for choosing this topic and inviting me. I wish the event a successful event, and I am sure you will be coming out with good recommendations, good decisions. Just send a copy of those decisions in context of your college, in context of Mungir University, in context of Bihar, in context of the country, in context of the new education policy, in context of going further, moving faster in the present era of smart materials and nanotechnology. Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, DC sir, for inspiring us and as well as for talking very interesting and important things about nanoscience and nanotechnology. We are very much thankful to you, sir. And now, for technical session of this webinar, we have with us, as Vice Chancellor sir has also said, that Dr. Kamal Prasad sir, he will be delivering his lecture on why nano behaves differently. But before he starts, I want to place a brief biodata of Dr. Kamal Prasad before all of you. Dr. Kamal Prasad is a professor at the University Department of Physics and Director of Computer Center, TM Bhagalpur University, Bhagalpur. He is having the teaching experience of 26 years in variety of organizations such as SLIT, Longowal, Punjab, Central University of Jharkhand, Ranchi, and Aryabhatta Knowledge University, Patna, a technical university. While working at Aryabhatta Knowledge University, Patna, as head of Center for Nanoscience and Nanotechnology, he established a well-equipped lab with high-end research instruments. Professor Prasad has successfully guided 12 PhD and 2 M.Tech students. He is working as the editorial board member of different journals, including Colloids and Surface B. He is an associate editor of International Journal IET Nanodielectrics. He has over 150 research publications to his credit, including 2 books, dozens of book chapters, and 16 X-ray diffraction reference data in JCPDS ICDD USA. His current research interests include synthesis and characterizations of eco-friendly ferroelectric piezoelectric ceramics, as well as ceramic polymer composites and advanced nanomaterials for different industrial applications. He is an active peer of different internationally renowned journals. He has delivered more than 30 invited lectures in different international and national conferences and workshops. And the most importantly, Google Scholar citations for Dr. Kamal Prasad's published research work is 3,900, with H index of 31 and I-10 index of 72, which truly proves scientific impact of his work. So now it's over to Dr. K. Prasad, sir. Sir.
Good morning, everyone. I'm very much thankful to my student, Anshu Kumar Roy, for giving me this opportunity to talk on this occasion. Are you listening me? Am I audible? Hello.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir, you are audible.
So,
sir, you are audible. Audible.
Okay. तुम उसमें लॉग ऑन कर दियो ना,
नहीं
कर दो यूट्यूब पर कर दो, सो हो गया सेम। हाँ माय स्क्रीन इज अपीयरिंग,
यस यस।
हाँ तो एज अंशु इंट्रोड्यूस दिस व्हाई नैनो बिहेव्स डिफरेंटली इज द टॉपिक फॉर माय टॉक टुडे। I am K. Prasad myself. So basically, I will talk today on the fundamentals why basically the nanomaterials behaves differently as a same material as a counterpart, say bulk or something like that. So before starting, see, in my view, the nano science and technology is basically based on the practicing material science at nano scale. See, therefore, it requires to understand the different components of material science and technology. See, basically, in material science and technology, we divide it into four parts. First is processing of materials is very important, and entire applications of materials depend upon the processing technique, because then the structure of the material, and upon structure of material then property and performances. So processing of materials has large impact upon the structure of the material, because it is processing which basically decides what type of structure we are getting after its processing, and the structure of the material will decide its ultimate property of the material. So certainly the processing has large impact on the property, ultimate property, what material will behave, how material will behave, and what will be its impact. So that will depend upon its processing. So processing is the whole crux behind material science and technology, and of course on nano, because nano is nothing but we are practicing nano material science at nano scale, nothing else different. See, we also know that the properties of the material influences the performance of the devices. So ultimately the structure, like cubic structure or whatever be the structure, the tetragonal and other structures, what we get from the material will ultimately decide the performance. And certainly it is processing technique which ultimately decides the performance of the material. So in material science, we basically design the material, production of material, and utilization of materials. So as Professor Verma said, the smart materials and advanced material, of course it is a part of nanoscience and technology and material science nowadays. So keep in mind that processing plays very or immense role in the performance of the material, right? Because in between structure and property comes. So you just see from this slide that we have three materials, disc shaped materials, which is alumina oxide basically. This is single crystal, this is translucent, and this is opaque one. We can produce material, so processing technique basically decides how it looks like and what will be the property. One is transparent, one is translucent, another is opaque. This is basically the processing technique, why material behave differently. You just see how it appears. So processing technique has immense role in the performance of the material. We have already seen nanotechnology. Nanotechnology is nothing new. So nanotechnology is already available in nature. The lotus effect, the famous lotus effect, might be in morning time you will see some dews on the leaf of the lotus. You just see this. If you put this lot, why it is not sticking to the surface, rather it is floating on the surface and it is not sticking onto the surface. If you put this leaf on the optical microscope, it will look like this granular structure. If you further increase put it in SEM, scanning electron microscope, then its structure looks like this granule. One grain has internal structure like this, some tubules are there. If you magnify it further, or from TEM study or some high resolution SEM study, then you just clearly see that this leaf is having the such tubules on the surface of the leaf. So this basically doesn't allow to stick this water droplet to stick on the surface. Similarly, we see the beautiful wings of the butterfly. Why it looks differently when it fold and unfold? When butterfly folds wings, then if you put the wings of the butterfly inside the optical microscope and then SEM and then HRSEM, then wings look like this one. So when it fold and unfold, light interacts. The interaction of light with its wing give you different color. So this is the things. Similarly, you might have seen the gecko, which easily climb on the smooth surface and vertical walls, but we cannot. Why? This is only due to its lamella. You just see the adhesive lamella. It looks normal, but when you put this lamella into SEM, then you will see that there are tubule-like structure, which basically, and if you further magnify it, it looks like this one. So this basically a small surface stick on the surface and give this gecko to put, go ahead on the vertical surface against the gravity. So basically, this is the nanotechnology in nature, and nanotechnology certainly provides you many, many applications what you think. Not only in science like physics, chemistry, biochemistry or biology, rather there are enormous applications in medicine, food technology, agriculture engineering, and various branches of engineering and forensic science and other things. So basically, in nanoscience and technology, we have to understand the science of atoms and molecules, and for that very purpose, we must know the science of electrons inside that. So if you understand these physical things, then certainly you understand atoms and molecules. And if you understand the behavior of this and science of this, you will understand the nanoscience and nanotechnology. And with your own choice, you can work in any branch of applying nanoscience and technology in any branch of science, engineering, medical, or whatever be the field. So in nutshell, nanoscale science and engineering can effectively improve our lives. So what is nanotechnology then? So nanotechnology, as Anshu says, nanotechnology is nothing but it is manipulation of matter at nanoscale to create nanostructures, devices, and systems.
The presentation has stopped.
Somebody else tried to intervene, actually.
Your presentation.
Now you carry on, Professor Prashad.
Yes.
Is it appearing on the screen?
Somebody tried to upload his presentation.
His slide is not visible, Anshu. Sir.
Anshu?
Okay, I am.
Yes, sir. Okay. Your slide is not.
No. You take the pin up.
Your slide is not visible, sir.
Anshu, no. You pin the slide of.
Pin your presentation.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. Then.
Kamal sir's slide. Kamal sir's ye.
Kamal sir's slide ka pin kar do bas.
Is appearing or not?
Kumar. Kumar is presenting.
1 minute, sir. 1 minute. In the slide?
Yes.
Coming? Should I start now?
1 minute, sir.
Come on, sir.
Actually, another one presenting the slide. So,
yeah, I don't know why they are doing. I'm also sending forwarding my slide to Anshu ji now.
Actually, she is also trying to present her work.
Remove.
Another.
So she is not remote. Trying to remove her, but Kumari Isu.
Anshu, sir, को एक बार फिर से connect करने के लिए हो जाएगा तो.
Yes, now Kumar sir, हम connect कर रहे हैं.
Now.
No, sir.
Yes, sir. Now you can.
Yes, sir.
But your screen, yes, sir. Your screen is visible, but yes, screen is visible, but slide is not coming.
Anshu, presentation slide को ले करो ना ये, pin करो ना उसको.
Yeah.
कमल सर का दो आता होगा presentation का.
अब आ रहा, आ रहा.
Yes.
Now visible, sir. Now.
Okay.
हाँ.
Okay, sir. Go on full screen, sir. Yes, sir. Okay.
So if we move towards the structure part, then any kind of materials, as Professor Verma said, that there are various kinds of nanomaterials or even materials, maybe composite, maybe ceramic, maybe metals, maybe alloys, maybe some other compounds, maybe natural materials. So all are covered under this structure part, right? So this here science will prevail. See, science. It is the duty of physicist and chemist to develop, and some engineers also, so develop some materials which is very useful for applications. Then comes the devices. If you apply such materials into devices, then maybe one example, the sensors like piezo sensors, pyroelectric sensors, humidity sensors. So you can make various types of devices. If you make, and the third category is the system as a whole. So only a small device may not serve the purpose of a whole technology. So we have to make a complete system, like a radar system or some other, say, artilleries and other systems. So in which various types of devices are incorporated. So taken together, nanotechnology serve in all these branches basically. And basically, in nanotechnology we have three terminologies frequently used. One is called nanoscience, where we procure the fundamental knowledge and we try to explain the phenomena and behaviors shown by different materials, right? And devices also. Then comes nanotechnology. It provides us the objective basically. What are the requirements? What are the things? What we want to develop? All these things are being given, all these things are being provided by nanotechnology. And then comes the third terminology, nanoengineering. See, this nanoengineering is nothing but it is basically the producing method or technology. We develop different methods how to prepare, including biological methods also, to produce different kinds of material. So these things, see, all are basically related. Very small changes are there, but anyway, aims are almost same. See, so if you are a nano bit curious, then what's interesting about the nano scale? So basically, nano sized particle exhibit different properties than the larger counterparts. It's larger particle of the same substance, and its properties and phenomenon and functions of those nanomaterials or nanoscale material will not be seen in the nano domain, outside the nano domain basically. So as we study the phenomenon at this scale, we learn more about the nature of the material, develop new theories, discover new questions and answers in many areas, including healthcare, energy, agriculture, biomedical, and other technological areas. See, and also we are interested in figuring out how to make new products and technologies that can improve our lives. So, if nano and nanotechnology are so important, then we first look at what are the nano scale basically. What is nano scale? See, the term nano comes from the Greek word nanos. And nanos means dwarf, means extremely small. If you compare our Mother Earth, which is approximately 1.27 10 to the power 7 meter wide in diameter, and suppose a football,
some problem, it seems.
Sir, your sound is not coming.
Yes, you are not audio audible, not Professor coming, Prashad. Sir. Yes, you are not audible, Professor Prashad.
Yes, his voice is not coming, sir.
I think connection is slow or network will be, sir. Network issue.
Yes, he is not audible. Yes.
Perhaps the connection is slow, sir. Internet speed is slow, I think.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Another issue is Professor Prasad's residence is just rear side of the radio station of Bhagalpur. There is always a problem of signal, even during the calls.
Yeah.
That may be the reason. Yes, he's back, and I think
Answer, sir. Please reconnect all the participants once again, I think. Leave the program once and reconnect once again. Ansu sir.
Should I start?
I think you are.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Is it appearing?
Deepak. No.
Actually, someone. Some other. Others are also trying to present their work. What to do?
Now, sir, you start presenting, sir. Please share your screen, sir.
Yes, yes, sir.
Ansu, sir.
Yes, yes, Tabarak, sir.
Please leave the program once and reconnect once again. I think it will work properly.
Now his presentation is appearing now.
Okay, if it is working, then good.
Make it full screen, sir.
Is it a
yes, yes.
So,
yes, sir, so it is clear. Compare, now it is visual.
So, if you compare nanomaterial with Mother Earth, you just see how much large structure in compared to the nanomaterial is. So, as Ansu rightly introduces, that nano is nothing but 1 billionth. So basically, nano is nothing but it is a prefix. Nano word is a prefix, basically. We have three fundamental quantity, length, mass, and time. So if you attach it with length scale, then it will be nanometer. Nanometer. Similarly, if you attach it with time scale, then nanosecond, and so on. So use. If you see here, 10 to the power 0, this is 1 meter. If you go right towards this meter, then we have kilometer 10 to the power 3. So positive power of 10. If you similarly, after decimal place, if you increase the number, say, if you go towards left, then minus power of 10 will be increasing. You just see here. Millimeter, micrometer, nanometer, picometer, and femtometer. So this is nothing but it is the game of length scale. So nanometer is the just size of a material which plays role. So it is just a prefix to the length scale that I wanted to say. So is therefore it is scale which changes everything. Like you just see in this example is this length scale. Around 1 meter the size of human. And similarly, if you go down towards this centimeter, the egg size, egg cells, and the millimeter size, and so on. Even a virus whose size is 10 to the power minus 7, 200 times, 300 times larger than nanometer size, even including coronavirus, whose size is 300 or 400 nanometer, say. So this comes under or covered under this scale. And then angstrom scale comes down to nanometer scale, that is atomic size or atomic dimension. And then femtometer, the atomic nucleus as the diameter or it ranges in this. So basically, we have enormous differences in that scale, length scale in the universe. At different scale, different forces dominate, and different models are available to explain different phenomena. So this we have to keep in mind at which length scale we are working, whether we are working on macro scale, micro scale, or nano scale. Everywhere science will be different and explanations will be different, its behavior will be different. So how one can realize the nano scale shape and size effect? How size and shape of the nanomaterials are affecting different things? So for just to understand this, we exemplify that if we take a bead whose height is h and approximately equal to its diameter, say d, suppose you stretch it, elongate it, then it will become a cylindrical wire type of structure where h is far, far, far greater than d, this cylindrical wire, but its structure will look differently than this bead. Similarly, if we hammer it, squeeze it, it will assume a disc where h is far less than its diameter. Height is, means thickness is far less than the diameter. So shape certainly will have different effect, different shape will have different effect on different properties. Just to understand a terminology which are generally used in the nanoscience is surface to volume ratio. If we take a cubic structure, a bar like this, rectangular bar like this, and you put this in the middle, then you just see its surface increases. How its surface increases, you just see length is same, breadth is same, but you just see this surface and this top surface is increased. So because of this attached, this one, a single bar, we have this much surface area, 6 faces, but we have increment in the faces. Similarly, if you take this one and cut it vertically and horizontally, then we have 4 such things, where we have the increment in the surface area of this here bottom and here up and here bottom. So this way, if you make it smaller and smaller like this, its surface area goes on increasing. I have put this into this picture. Like suppose you have taken a 1 meter cube whose area will certainly be 6 meter square. 6 faces are there, so 6 meter square. If you cut it horizontally and vertically like this, then you increase the surface area because we have 6 faces and half its size. We are making half cut on all 3 dimensions. Then we have to multiply 8 because we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 8 such cubes. So multiplied, taken together, it is 12 meter square. So similarly, if we have 3 cuts along horizontal, vertical, and 3 dimensional cut, then we have the increment in the surface area like 18 meter square. So if you go on making the things smaller, then surface area goes on, increases, keeping the volume same. So this has been modeled here also. If you have, suppose a surface energy of 1 face is gamma, and we have 6 faces of this cube, so 6 gamma will be the energy, surface energy of this cube. Similarly, for this cube also, 6 gamma, so taken together, we have 12 gamma surface energy of 2 cubes. But if you agglomerate it, combine it, then 2 faces will not be exposed. So it will become 10 gamma agglomerated particles. So energy goes down in this case. So greater amount of surface come into the context of surrounding materials. So that is why the catalytic, whether it is catalytic property or its other properties, enhanced properties are being seen in nanoscale. So this is the effect of size and shape of nanoparticle in different areas. Similarly, the electromagnetic force dominance of electromagnetic force. As you see that as we go into nanoscale, its mass goes on reducing. So negligibly small mass will be realized. So gravitational force, which is a function of mass and distance, will have negligibly small or weak contribution towards gravitational force on nanoparticle. Similarly, electromagnetic force, which is a function of charge and distance, are not affected because it is not depending upon mass, and which is very strong as compared to gravitational force. And we know that electromagnetic forces between two protons is 10 to the power 36 times stronger than gravitational force. So as you go on decreasing the size, then mass goes on decreasing. So we have gravitational force, negligibly gravitational force will be acting upon it, while electromagnetic force remains increased or same. Similarly, the quantum size effect or quantum effect. So in the morning, both Ansu and as well as Professor Verma told that the bulk gold looks yellow, but the nano gold is, the color of nano gold is size dependent. This is 12 nanometer gold, which looks red. And if you go on decreasing its size, its look, lastly, it is blue. So it is quantum effects. Basically, classical mechanical model that we use to understand matter at macro scale breaks down at the nano scale. That is very small. And it breaks for very fast. Means when speed of light, we acquire speed of light, then classical mechanics fails to explain those phenomena. That is why quantum mechanical model better describe these phenomena compared to classical mechanics, like color of nano gold, and probability instead of certainty will come into picture. Basically, what happens if you if you go on nano sizing, then number of atoms in the material will go on decreasing. So if materials content in the material goes on decreasing, then band gap goes on increasing. So that is what has been cartoonized in this picture we just see. And since here the bands are not appearing, because in bulk metal bands are not appearing because it looks continuous, that is why its property will be different, and it breaks, its spacing goes on increasing if you decrease the size of nanoparticle. And for single atom, you will have the band gap higher, and we have single such band occurring, conduction band and valence band. So this is why, and you can recognize this equation, well-known equation. You just see band gap of nano is directly proportional to the radius of the, matlab size of the nanoparticle, square of the size of this nanoparticle. That is why, as we decrease the size, its color goes on decreasing. Similarly, another things what is happening with this nanoparticle is the random molecular motion prevails. As you go on decreasing the size, what happens? A tiny particle moves randomly and scatter or interact between each other, and its motion will be random, and Brownian motion prevails, and thermodynamic fluctuations come into picture, like dust particle it moves randomly and bulk particle cannot move, or you hardly see its movement. So such things should be taken care of when you deal with nanomaterials. Same, if I take one example, the physical property like of nanomaterial, like melting point. Melting point is nothing but it is the temperature at which atom or ion or molecule in a substance have enough energy to overcome the intermolecular forces that hold them in a fixed position in the solid. So at macro scale, what happens? Entire particle R remains in the bulk, interior of the bulk. But in nano scale, the most of the particles come on the surface. So this leads to the surface atoms leads to have large impact on the physical and chemical properties of the nanomaterial. So melting point doesn't depend upon its size, how long or how small. If you heat it, it will melt. And similarly, it melting point goes on decreasing for a smaller particle. So this is the reason why melting point of nanoscale particle is lower. This has again be illustrated in this slide. You just see this is the surface atom. This one is in contact with three atoms, this, this, and this. While the interior of this particle is in contact with seven or surrounded with seven such atoms. That is why less energy is required to move this away from this surface. So that is why, as we see that in nanoscale material, all the particles come, most of the particles come on the surface. That is why, and it is easy to remove them out or play with those things. So that is why we have fewer atoms at the surface of the substance. So we eat different, or it behaves differently. So as we shown in earlier slide, that fabrication technique is playing most important role in deciding the ultimate performance of the material. So we are basically having two types of approaches in the fabrication of nano material. One is macroscopic material, another is molecular, see, atom as molecular. One is top down approach, where we cut the smaller particles, or we change larger structures into a smaller one. Like this is the cartoon where larger structures are being, this person is cutting the larger structure so that we have. Am I audible now? Hello?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
My slides are appearing? No.
Slide is not appearing.
Now it is appearing.
Yes, sir, it is appearing.
Now
yes, sir, it is appearing.
Okay. So we have two basic approaches for fabrication of nanomaterials. One is called top-down approach, where large structures are converted into smaller structures. And another bottom-up approach, what we do is smaller structures to grow into larger, the supramolecular chemistry approach or other things are there. So you just see here the cartoon. We have larger structures. We are cutting into different pieces so that we have smaller structures. And at the right-hand side, we have smaller structures. If you combine them, then we have larger structures taken together. So we have different methods for nanomaterial synthesis. The physical method, chemical method, and biological methods. There are many methods which is covered under physical methods, the ball milling, thermal evaporation, lithographic technique, paper his epitaxial coat and others. Similarly, we have different chemical methods like sol gel, hydrothermal, and other interfacial technique like air water interface, water oil interface, non-polar organic solvent interface, and other things. Similarly, we have biological methods for the synthesis of different nanomaterials like bacteria, fungi, yeast, plant extract, fruit juice, food beneficiary, and etc. We, since it is natural material, so we call it nature's nanofactory, and this will be the focal theme of the next talk, by which will be delivered by Dr. Anil Kanha. I'm not going into thick and thin of this technique. So question arises, can animal too participate in this? So this will be answered by Dr. Jha itself. So, but the whole crux behind nanomaterial synthesis is, it's all the game of energy. Somehow you have to generate energy either for top-down approach or for bottom-up approach. Then only you can produce different varieties of nanomaterials. This is the book where all the things have been described. So, come to few applications of nanotechnology. So, covering entire examples and entire applications is not a joke. We cannot cover, but anyway, I have few examples to cover in this lecture. A paint. This is paint technology, which cleans air basically. But if you lap such paints, nano-enabled paints, on the surface of the building, then when exposed to ultraviolet light, the titanium dioxide nanoparticle in the paint breaks down the organic and inorganic pollutants that wash off in the rain and decompose air-polluting gases like formaldehyde and traps different types of gases like COX, DOX, and NOX, bacteria, fungi, etc. So, such type of building purifies the air, and paint is long-lasting, anti-fade, and preventing the mildews. So nano-enabled paints are available in the market nowadays. So this is one of the examples. In cosmetology, cosmetic industry, we have seen various kinds of anti-aging cream, sunscreens. You just might have recognized that earlier days, in the cricket ground, the faces of
the namaskar.
Hello. Faces look like this one, the whitey patch.
Hello.
Am I audible?
Sir, please speak. You are audible, sir.
Okay. Actually, the sunscreen contains zinc oxide particles. So, zinc oxide, earlier days, you just see this is white patches were seen on the faces of the players just to protect them from ultraviolet light, from the sun, and etc. No. But nowadays, they are using same sunscreen, but which has been launched by L'Oreal in the market, which you cannot recognize that they are using sunscreen because it doesn't allow, and it looks clear basically because it allows to use nano sized zinc and nano titanium dioxide, which enables for the production of greasy and non oily screen. Actually, what happens when you use large zinc oxide particles, it blocks UV light, scatter visible light, so that it appears white. Nano-sized zinc oxide particle blocks UV light, so it's small, and it is so small compared to visible light that they do not scatter it and appears clear. And this cartoon you might be seeing, that this old lady are using this cosmetic anti-aging cream from Sunwax, and it looks younger than
no.
This is the X-ray, and this is the TEM picture of nano-sized zinc oxide particle. We have also contributed significantly to some product development and technology development in this field. So I want to show you some of them, and I want to share you so that you can also develop such type of experimentation and such type of technique in your own lab. Zinc oxide nanoparticle we use for water purification. You just see beautiful X-ray and TEM picture for which clearly shows that it is nano-sized zinc oxide. What we did is we took zinc oxide nanoparticle in a flask, this tube-like thing, and here we allow this H2S gas to pass through it. Since nano zinc oxide has the property to absorb the H2S gas, then so here it is lead acetate solution. It prevents to happen black. So after 25 minutes and so, or 20 minutes and so, it doesn't gone black. So it means zinc oxide, nano zinc oxide has a adhesive property which absorb the H2S gas. And and other properties, so it nullify the bad odors. Next thing what we did is, the zinc oxide, colloidal zinc oxide particles, we spreaded on such type of dirty places, and no bad gases or smell were, or other bad odors were recognized. So this way zinc oxide have very good effect on adsorption property. Similarly, we have water purification system from application from alumina nanoparticle, carbon coated alumina nanoparticle. We just see the pH, TSS and TDS of underground water and river water. And after filtration, you just see the peak quantity pH drastically reduced, TSS reduces drastically, and TDS also reduces drastically in both the categories of water. So nanomaterial effectively can be used to purify water also. Similarly, we have tried to develop a face mask using three categories of nanomaterials prepared from different techniques. I cannot disclose because a patent has been filed on this. So this can protect not only gaseous emission, rather it will also protect from virus, fungus and pollens. It will help the doctors who is doing autopsy and clinician, municipal worker, and it will help in protecting the biological socks and knocks. Another example, what towards the energy harvesting and sensing, we develop some nano composite material which is placed here, and this particular arrangement we made in our laboratory. This is the weight, standard weight, which has been allowed to drop from through this guided wire or on this. And since this is piezoelectric property, what will happen? It will develop charge by this impact, and this will be taken care of this DSO, digital storage oscilloscope. So this is the experimental setup for creation of electrical signal from ceramic polymer nanocomposites. So we have developed sodium bismuth titanate and CVDF nanocomposite, and allowed the weight to drop from different heights. So this is different composite, PVDF, and this is 30% of NBT, and you just see the electrical signal is increasing by increasing the NBT. So signal strength goes on increasing by increasing the composition of nanocomposites. So composition increment means we are increasing the sodium bismuth titanate particle, nanoparticle in the composite, so that signal strength goes on increasing because NBT is well known piezoelectric material. So in this picture you can clearly see that if we goes on increasing the NBT component, you just see the voltage what we received in DSO, distal storage oscilloscope, goes on increasing for each and every composition. Just see. Similarly, if we increase the height of impact, means we are increasing the force, we are increasing the mechanical energy, applied mechanical energy on the material, then also you just see it is increasing. Certainly, we are converting energy, one kind of energy into electrical signal. The mechanical energy has been converted into electrical signal by using this nanocomposite. So by increasing NBT content, voltage increases, and by increasing impact, that is force or energy, then also electrical signal strength goes on increasing. So signal strength or contact voltage goes on increasing with height of impact as well as NBT content. The details are being published in this paper. You can go through this, interested readers. So similarly, if we see that the same voltage, if you convert it into energy, then if you increase the height of impact, then also the generated energy goes on increasing. And similarly, if you increase the NBT, the concentration, then also it is so generated energy increases with the height of impact as well as NBT content. So this is the science why basically we are having such type of signal received from such material, this nanomaterial. Basically, such nanomaterials is having, since NBT is having TiO dipole and TiO6 octahedra, because it is perovskite type of material. So this way TiO dipoles are there. This I have tried to make it clear from this cartoon, where you just see the dipoles. By the application of impact, that is load, if you apply this, what will happen? The dipoles will align themselves towards this, and it will align like this horizontally, and material will polarize like this. So what will happen basically? There are three phenomena happens when you such materials get impacted. First thing is that if you apply normal stress to this material, then there are certain grains which am I audible now?
Yes, you are clearly audible.
Carry on. Sir, audible. You are audible.
Carry on, please. Okay. Thank you.
So normal stress will produce shear stress on the component of grains of NBT, right? So what will happen? This will set up TiO dipoles to oscillate, and this oscillating dipoles will lead to the generation of electrical signal, right? And secondly, what will happen? The TiO6 octahedra, which is present in the bulk of this or the unit cell of NBT, will, when impacted, what will happen? The dimension will go on alter, means it will squeeze. So certainly when you apply stress or apply load to the things, and it will sample will alter its dimensions, then certainly TiO6 octahedra will also its shape or size will also go on altering. So alteration of TiO6 octahedra means the variation, we are going to change the variation in the separation distance of dipoles. And this gives you the time varying dipole moment, and the timing varying dipole moment will lead to the generation of electrical signal. And thirdly, what will happen? The charges which is there on the plates of this material, opposite plates of this material, which have been developed during cooling, will allow to come down towards the lower electrode, and this leads to the positive signal. So effectively, it gives you positive signal. And in contrary to this, if you release the load, these dipoles will realign themselves in the original direction, and this charge will go up, and so that we have down signal. So this is the whole mechanism behind generation of signal in the nanocomposite material. And there are various applications of such type of material, like we have bent like this while walking or running. This will stress, this such material will feel stress. So what will happen? It will generate signal. And if you connect some electronic gadgets or connect some battery with this such type of electronic gadget, then it will store energy. Similarly, this cartoon you just see, if we apply alternating force to this material, piezoelectric material, it generates voltage, and if you allow in reverse direction, it will come down. So present nanocomposites can be used in structure health monitoring, different sensing, and energy harvesting or generating applications. You might have recognized that in previous slide, that while impacting, the signals were random. So just to make signal height smooth or same, we used the principles of electronics. That is, we used electrical engineering principle like RC filter. We used RC filter, standard RC filter, along in between the material and digital storage oscilloscope. Then you just see that the signal strength are almost same. The generated voltage, signal strength are almost same. So this way you can have signal strength same. So you can use it in energy harvesting applications in your lab also. And this is just scientific thing. If you increase the capacitance, the value of RC, C, capacitance value, then this strength goes on decreasing. You just see black one, red one, and then blue one. So this 0.008 microfarad capacitance, if you use, then the signal strength goes on decreasing. Similarly, this has appeared in this AIP proceedings this year. So in our lab, what we did is, we always encourage a student to, in electronics lab, to use IC555 timer circuit, which is very much a standard timing circuit. This has been connected in a free running multivibrator, a stable multivibrator mode. This is resistance and this. And what we did is, this capacitance, we replace this standard capacitance with our own fabricated capacitor with composite, NBT and other composite. And we allow this ball to drop on this. The weight is allowed to drop on this. So what will happen? Since this is piezoelectric composite, then it will generate voltage or charge along its surface. So capacitance will go on increasing, right? One capacitance will go on increasing. The formula is the width time period of this, the on time, this W is directly proportional to this capacitance and this R, RA plus RB, 2RB, right? So if keeping, if you keep these RA and RB fixed and change the capacitance value, how you are changing? By put impacting this ball or dropping this weight on this composite, this capacitance value changes. This will reflect on this width. This width will go on increasing or decreasing accordingly. So in one sense, and if you connect here the 741 type of IC here, operational amplifier, then you convert it into voltage again. So if you drop here weight mechanically, then you get here signal. So this will certainly a sensor like circuit. So this such type of circuit you can so I request all the teachers who is listening today, who are listening today, and students of engineering as well as science who is listening today, can try such type of circuit by making very small circuit and such type of arrangement. You one can realize like humidity sensor, temperature sensor, and this impact sensor and flow sensor. Many things can be realized by just this is low cost experiment development program we are working on to it. So you can always work on this. So you just see, this is mimic pin 2. You just see here pin 2 and or 6 and pin 1. You just connect pin 2 and 6, 2 and 1, this capacitor, and you allow pressure or load or temperature, whatever, and it will sense accordingly. This width will increase and decrease. You can always have sensor like structures. So this was all about the my presentation, but lastly I want to say the few scopes of nanotechnology. See, nanotechnology has a magnificent scope in different walks of our life, like manpower development, higher educational institution, research and development, educationists and trainers, entrepreneurship development program, and youth training. There are various areas where nanotechnologists, the need of trained manpower in nanotechnology are used and getting employment from these things. See, it ensures clean and green environment like waste recycling and other things, the nanotechnology. Certainly, as we have already discussed, that medical as well as health sector especially get benefited through nanotechnology in years to come and ensures the better lifestyle. Agriculture and food technology have better scope from nanotechnology, and above these, the employment generation is also covered under nanotechnology, because this is upcoming branch of science and technology, and many new opportunities are being explored and yet to come and yet to realize. So huge number of nanotechnology trained personnels will be required in coming future, so that we can develop. So employment generation is also a part of nanotechnology, and certainly if everything will work in positive direction, so economical and as well as sustainable growth will be ensured to have by employing them in small and medium scale industry, so that taken together we have the R&D different types of growth. If you have such type of things to come into picture, so we have to work and join hands together, so that nanotechnology offers great promises for your future. I will fail in my duties if I not take the names of few of my friends and colleagues who are really contributing to develop or to work with me in or contributing me in such a program. Let me first talk about this, my friend and my colleague, Dr. Anil Kanjha, who is with this, and of course, he will talk just after this talk. And second is Professor A.R. Kulkarni from IIT Mumbai, who has helped us a lot. And this is Amit Kumar, Dr. Amit Kumar. He is Assistant Professor of Mechanical Engineering in BIT Patna. And many doctors are in our group, like P.K. Jha, Dr. P.K. Jha in IGIMS Patna, U. Devi in PGIMS Chandigarh, and Dr. S. Patankar, Ace Hospital Pune, who is giving us or offering a helping hand to have our products, our materials at the trial stage or into medical field. So this was all. So if you have any question, then please.
Thank you, sir. There are some questions in chat box. So some Shivani Gupta, she is asking, are there any specific health or other risks from nano products? Are there any specific health or other risks from nano products?
Actually, see, as you have seen in my third or fourth slide, that mass is very small, and so certainly if you put this material in just in air, then certainly it will move here and there, and if you inhale this directly, then certainly it will have some adverse effect on the body.
Discuss that part.
Also, another question.
This part will be better answered by Dr. Anil in his talk.
And another question, sir. From the same person, Shivani Gupta, what professional journal covers nanotech related issue? What journals?
See, there are large number of journals. One cannot name, but anyway, see, it all depends upon your field. If you are working in materials, nanomaterials, then there will be separate journals. If you are working in medical area, then separate journals. If you are working on food technology and agriculture, then there are journals. See, it depends upon, see, if you are interested in material science, then material science and engineering, colloids and surfaces, journal of colloids and interface science, materials today, nano today. See, there are various. So you just note my email ID. If you have any questions related such type of thing, you can contact me anytime. I will answer you. So there are many SCI, Scopus, or WS Index Journal, which you can publish. Whole crux behind all these things, you first judge yourself. You just see your work, where to publish. See, there are various journals whose impact factors are 40, 45, 47, or even 60. But we cannot go for those publications. We have to judge our work accordingly. I have to make judicious choice of choosing the journal. So that is the main point.
Sir, one more question we can take. Shahnawaz Ali, he is asking that, sir, how can we confirm whether a given sample or material is nanomaterial or bulk material?
Actually, the preliminary confirmation is that if you take X-ray of same material well in bulk state or same material in nano state, right, then you will recognize that X-ray is broadening in X-ray, right? Then if you do UV, then UV, the peak in UV, resonance peak will occur at different places, right? So, you recognize.
Thank you, sir.
And TEM picture.
Some questions. There are some questions also, but I have shared your email ID. If someone has any question, then they can mail you. So thank you, sir. You talked that nanotechnology is already available in nature. You also talked about various applications of nanotechnology, defined nanotechnology brilliantly, defined it, also made us aware of surface to volume ratio's importance. Your speech was really reflecting true purpose of this webinar. I think it will be useful and helpful to students aspiring to work in nano field, as well as it will help understanding basic of this subject to faculty members and research scholars. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You can stop presenting, sir. Please stop presenting.
My slides are with you, Anshuji, I suppose.
Yes, sir.
This is them. That's data. Kamal, khatam ho.
Kamal, sir, please stop presenting now. Now, the next speaker. 1 minute. Now we have the next speaker, Dr. Anil Kant Jha. He will deliver his lecture on nanoscience and living systems, promises and its limitations. So I am presenting his brief biodata before all of you. Dr. Anil Kant Jha did his MSc in botany from Bhagalpur University in 1988 and MPhil in biochemistry from the University of Cambridge, United Kingdom in 1990. As a beneficiary of the ODA Cambridge Scholarship, a major portion of his MPhil work was presented at the Royal Society discussion meeting on NMR imaging in June 1990, which subsequently got published in the Philosophical Transaction of the Royal Society, London. After his return from UK, he obtained his PhD in plant biochemistry in 1993 from TM Bhagalpur University, Bhagalpur. He continued his postdoctoral work till 1997 at University of Nottingham with late Professor Sir Peter Mansfield, a Nobel laureate, and Professor Peter Morris on MRI. And on return, he worked at Bhagalpur University. In 2001, he went to the JNU New Delhi as research associate and worked on plant biotechnology at the School of Life Sciences. Again, on return in 2002, he joined as faculty in the newly established Department of Biotechnology at Marwari College, TM Bhagalpur University, Bhagalpur, till 2009. He started working on bio-nanotechnology from 2004 in active collaboration with Dr. Kamal Prasad. He just talked before him, University Department of Physics, TM Bhagalpur, University Bhagalpur. He has worked as an assistant professor in Center for Nanoscience and Nanotechnology at Aryabhatta Knowledge University, Patna, from August 12 to September 19. He has currently 64 publications, 12 international book chapters, and many nano-based products and processes to his credit. He is also an active peer of different internationally renowned journals. Dr. Jha is honorary technical consultant of Texol International, Maxwell India, and IAB Science. He is an active member of International Community on Nanoscience, Materialia Indica, and a fellow of Cambridge Commonwealth Society. Presently, he is working at University Department of Physics, TM Bhagalpur University, Bhagalpur. So I now request Dr. Jha to please present.
Okay, thank you very much, honorable. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. I am trying to present your slides, sir.
Thank you, Anshuji. Thanks for this brilliant, very nice and very kind introduction.
Sir, is it visible? Slides are visible? Sir?
Yes, Anshuji, visible.
Oh.
Yes, Anshuji, it is clearly yes, visible.
Okay, thank you.
Visible.
Now, sir, it's full screen now. Sir, Anal, sir. Anal, sir. Anal, sir. Sir, please start. Anal, sir. Anal, sir. Anal, sir. He is not present. Bhargav sir, Tawarak sir, are you listening to me? Hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Anal sir is not present there. He is present.
Yes.
And his slides are, I think now, it is visible.
Yeah, slide is visible.
But
Anal sir was present here, but at present
maybe some network issue.
Yeah, network issue.
Yeah, 1 minute, I'm just calling him.
Please see his mic is not mute.
Oh, 1 minute. Anal sir, where is he? He is not in the meeting presently.
Mm.
1 minute. I have talked to him, he is trying to connect because of some data issue. He has been disconnected, so wait for 1 or 2 minutes. And I have repeated many times, I typed in chat box that please mute your audio, but someone, most of the people are unmuting and speaking. So it is creating disturbance in the meeting. Also, they are starting presenting. So these things, please stop. I am requesting to all the participants once again. Please do not present your screen. And also, you are requested not to unmute your audio. Please mute your audio. Please wait, Dr. Jha is trying to connect because of some data issue. He has been disconnected. So within, I think, 1 or 2 minutes, he will be joining with all of us.
Thank you.
Anshu sir. Anshu sir.
Yes, Tabarak sir.
If any problem, I think the chance should be given to Bhargava sir.
He is, in fact, he is trying to connect. So one or two minutes we are waiting. Then, Bhargav sir, are you there? Bhargav sir.
He is trying. If
Bhargav sir.
If Anil Kant Jha sir is trying, then okay. Otherwise.
Yes, he is trying. He is trying. Okay. Bhargav sir. Bhargav sir, Bhargav sir, Anand sir, Anand sir. जो भी हाँ एड कर अनल सर सर ये ज्वाइनिंग ज्वाइनिंग वेट वेट अनल सर ही ज्वाइनिंग अनल सर अनल सर still not joined. Yes, yes. Anal sir, please unmute yourself. Anal sir, please unmute yourself. You have been muted. Anal sir. Anal sir. Anal sir. Anal sir. Please unmute yourself. Yes, yes.
Now I'm audible to you all.
Yes,
sir. There was a serious.
Yes,
sir. Yeah, no. I'm sorry. I'm really sorry. My apologies to you all. And there was serious networking with me. That's why I got delayed. My, I must express my gratitude, sincere sense of gratitude to the convener, honorable principal, honorable vice chancellor, sir, honorable principal, sir, and other members of the college system, KMD College Parbatta. It's a nice event. Before me, Kamalji talked, and I have little training in nanoscience and technology. And I would like to just share my experience with you all, one by one, that how nature, how living systems are linked to the nanoscience and technology. How do they influence each other? So the next. So these slides कैसे yes, change कर सकते
yes. आप next बोलेंगे मैं कर दूंगा सर
हाँ next
okay सर
video glitch हुआ तो video बंद
hello
yes second slide is not visible sir
second slide
is visible or not sir
no it is not showing but I can
outline of presentation.
Outline of presentation.
Is it not coming, outline of presentation?
No, sir. Should I do it from here itself or what? Sorry.
Now it's coming or not, sir?
No, sir. It's not coming. That's the real issue. That's the problem. Network, the big issue.
Slide is not moving. Sir, is slide? Our slides are not moving.
No, they are not moving, sir.
Oh,
no, sir.
Oh, not moving, no?
Slide is still stationary.
Okay.
Oh.
Yeah. Okay, so I should do it from my end this time. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Kamalji has done. Okay, I'm just getting back, and I'll.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Where are the slides?
Now moving, na sir. Now these are moving, I think. Tabarak sahab. Tabarak sahab.
Yes, sir. Slide is not showing here.
Slide not showing.
No, sir.
Oh.
मैं कहाँ से शुरू कर रहा था? ठीक है. Next पर आइए.
Next time. एक मिनट. हो जाएगा सर. वो अभी हो रहा था.
हाँ अभी था.
अभी आया था सर. एक मिनट.
The things, but effort is worth praise because you have tried this thing at a place like Parvat. It's a great thing, isn't it? Yes.
Yeah. Coming. It's coming now.
I mean, okay, right. So yes, the sir. Next one.
Next.
Bio nanotechnology. आगे बहुत आगे चले गए अंशु जी.
Oh, sorry, sir.
Slide skip हो गया है. इंट्रोडक्टरी आस्पेक्ट पर जाना होगा, हम आगे बढ़ रहे हैं, पीछे आ रहे हैं।
One minute, sir.
No problem. Next, go to next, my dear friend. Kamal ji is also online.
Yes, sir. Now outline of presentation.
Oh, I'm sorry. So I pick up again. Thank you very much for your patience. And this is the brief outline of my presentation. I'll take up little bit of introductory aspect. Where do the nature, the living system, and the nanoscience cohere? And involvement of living systems in nanoscience. How can we get them into use? My expertise, past expertise, and then bio-nanoscience and technology. How can we evolve into life science to bio-nanoscience to bio-nanotechnology? And different means and methods, how could we take use of the living systems or even the dead portions of the living bodies to synthesize different materials? And then I will conclude. Thanks. Next one, please. Yes. These are the brief introductory aspects. We'll have to understand the nature first. Scientific research is required for that. We need to see every particle of this nature with a scientific perspective. And thus, in our Hindu mythology, we have a philosophy of completeness. The philosophy of completeness says a lot. That is Purnamidam, Purnamadam, Purnat, Purnamudachyate, Purnasya, Purnamadaya, Purnameva Visishyate. That means in itself, our universe is a Brahma, it is constant. That is complete in itself in all respects. And it is, its components are interacting with each other to manifest different phenomena. It's probably true and applicable from the collapse of stars to assembly of materials, including nanomaterials. Next one, please. This is all happening in nature. Nature is ruled by the principles of thermodynamics, supramolecular chemistry. That is what we call nanomaterials. Right from the growth of a leaf, flower, bud,
hello sir, anal sir, your voice is not coming. Anal sir, sir, your voice is not coming. Anal sir, sir, you are connected but your voice is not coming. Sir, anal sir, 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 your voice is not coming, sir. Anal sir has been disconnected now. Yes.
लॉकडाउन ही लॉकडाउन खुलता ना सितंबर में बस टूटना शुरू है।
प्लीज म्यूट योरसेल्फ पार्टिसिपेंट्स। Anal sir,
हाँ सर डिस्कनेक्ट हो गए हैं। अच्छा नेटवर्क भार्गव सर, भार्गव सर
हेलो।
हाँ ओके ओके सर, आई वाज जस्ट चेकिंग दैट यू आर प्रेजेंट और नॉट। थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू भार्गव सर, थैंक यू। अनल सर इज ट्राइंग टू कनेक्ट वंस अगेन।
ओके
जी सर, भार्गव सर का करा देना। ठीक है इनका, ठीक है सर, ठीक है। नेटवर्क कट जा रहा है वहीं से लग रहा है उनका। जी सर, ठीक है सर, भार्गव सर को बोलते हैं। ठीक है, थैंक यू। भार्गव सर,
हाँ सो
कैन यू स्टार्ट नाउ? यू आर प्रिपेयर्ड?
या
So you can now, one minute. So Dr. Jha is not able to connect once again because of some network issue. So I am just changing the program and we have as a third speaker, Dr. K.K. Bhargav is here. So now I will invite him, Dr. K.K. Bhargav, for his presentation. But before I invite him, I would like to present brief biodata of Dr. Krishna Kumar Bhargav. Dr. Krishna Kumar Bhargav did his PhD from Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur in 2014. After completing his PhD, he joined at Aryabhatta Knowledge University, Patna as guest faculty and worked at Center for Nanoscience and Nanotechnology of this university from January 15 to June 15. He also taught at Suraj Degree College, Mahendragarh, Maharshi Dayanand University, Rohtak, Haryana from July 15 to June 17 as an assistant professor. From September 17 onwards, he is working as an assistant professor at KDS College, Gogri, Munger University, Munger. He has 10 research publications to his credit in journals of international repute. He has also published or presented more than 20 research papers in conferences and seminars. He was awarded with Best Poster Presentation Award in National Seminar on Ferroelectrics and Dielectrics, NSFD 2012. Dr. Bhargav has expertise in different instrument skills as well as proficiency in different softwares used for data analysis in the field of scientific research. So now I would like to request Dr. Bhargav to present, because Dr. Anilkant Jha sir is not able to connect. Perhaps he has connected, but Anil sir?
Yes, yes, Dr. I'm there.
Okay, sir. So
let Bhargav proceed first.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Oh, Bhargav sir, you may proceed now.
Thank you, Dr. Anshu.
You can share your screen, sir.
Yes. Entire screen.
Screen is not coming, Bhargav sir.
Yes, yes, I will try.
Okay, sir.
First of all, share screen. Entire screen, na?
Present now. Then your entire screen.
Present now.
Then your entire screen.
Entire screen. Then after share.
Ji. Click on the icon first. Then share. Picture which is coming.
Okay. Yes, yes.
Yeah, now it's coming. Now it's coming. Now it's fine.
Okay.
Make it full screen, sir. Make it full screen. Yes, now it's okay.
Are you clear?
Yes, yes, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Anshu, for kind information for me. Today my topic is nanocrystalline perovskite material with gas sensing and other multifunctional properties. Are you audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible. You are audible.
Yes, sir.
Proceed.
Here the figure shows perovskite material or ABO3 structures. Lanthanum ferrite, LaFeO3, ABO3 type structures, it's called perovskite material, perovskite type structures, which is very flexible structures, which is used in gas sensing and other multifunction properties like electrical and magnetic, also catalytic and photocatalytic properties. What is nanostructure materials? Nanostructure materials as a crystalline, amorphous, and porous. Nanostructure material amorphous nanoglass, also for porous materials, which is used in gas sensing. Nanostructure material also crystalline materials. Nanocrystal materials, distribution of extremely small particles may or may not be by a pore of small dimensions with distinct boundaries and or interface at high frequency. High energy in nanometers scale, design a nanostructure in preponderance of surface atoms or surface energy. It can be classified into three groups as amorphous, porous, and crystallines. In case of crystalline, called a nanocrystalline material, characterized by small crystallite size of the order of few nanometers, usually 2 to 20 nanometers, depending upon the shape. Crystallites are separated by high angle grain or interface boundaries. There are three types of porous materials: microporous, mesoporous, and macroporous. Microporous diameters less than 2 nanometers, dimension is 2 nanometers, less than 2 nanometers, and mesoporous materials is between 2 and 15 nanometers. And next is macroporous, dimension is greater than 15 nanometers. Depending upon the dimension in particles, a nanoporous material may be crystalline or amorphous. Nanostructure has modified bulk properties. Our topic related to the perovskite structures of orthoferrites and its origin of multifunctionality. Proposed real means very flexible structures. This is general formula is ABO3. ABO3 type structures. It contains two cation sublattices and one anion sublattices. One of the cation sublattices is formed by a cation with coordination number 12 situated between oxygen octahedral. This oxygen is octahedral, while the second sublattices build up by B cations with coordination number 6 occupation appropriate site inside the octahedral. It's a, also ABO3 structure tolerance factors calculated from this formula Ra plus Ro divided by under root 2 Rb plus Ro. Radius of A cation, Rb is the radius of B cation, and Ro is the radius of oxygen. It's due to very flexible structure, this shows very functional function material type. It also shows superoxygen interaction in interferometric in natures. Also, DM type interactions, it shows ferromagnetic type nature. Due to canting, the spin moment in two sublattices are not completely concealed and yield a small ferromagnetic moment along the C axis of the unit cell. Ferromagnetic coupling shows spin polarized currents. Antiferromagnetic coupling shows antiferromagnetic due to spin polarized current due to antiferromagnetic coupling. This shows the type G type in antiferromagnetic materials. Introduction for multifunctionality, it shows gas sensing, catalytic activity, ferroelectric, magnetic, and magnetodielectric properties. First of all, we explain the gas sensing materials, why it is very low temperature gas sensing materials, which we know basic information about why gas sensors. The emission of pollutant gas to the atmosphere by combustion engine and industrial process has been sustainable contribution to the global warming, causing unpredictable weather changes worldwide with many dramatic consequences, in that is in mines, automobiles, fire alarm, also breath testing, so useful in many applications of gas sensors. But I have chosen the gas sensing material as semiconducting types. This semiconducting material, metal oxide based gas sensor, are very much popular due to their small size, low price, high sensitivity, and long lifetime. Hello, Anshu. Are you audible?
Yes, sir. Clearly audible. You are okay, audible, okay. Sir.
Yes, yes. This type of proboscide material is semiconducting oxide based material. What is sensor? Sensor is a device which gives a response or signal to change its surrounding in terms of temperature, pH, selective gases, and stress pressure. And different types of sensor in our application. Material is used for gas sensing materials. It converts a physical or chemical change into a measurable parameter such as electrical signals. Classification of sensors. Sensor classified into on the basis of principle of operation, output signals, and depends on its type of materials, which type of materials. In the sensing and sensing mechanism, there are three S problems: sensitivity, selectivity, and stability. Three S problem is sensitivity means it is defined as a change in electrical resistance in presence of gas of a given concentration. Means percentage of sensitivity we have calculated from a resistance in air minus a resistance in gas divided by resistance in air into 100. Calculate from this formula, we have calculated the sensitivity of the material. And selectivity means change in resistance differs in different gases. For example, my sample used in carbon monoxide, LPG, and methane sensing. So it is very selective in butane sensing materials. So maybe for ceramic materials, it is very difficult to distinguish the selectivity for the materials. Our materials is used in very selective for butyl sensing. Stability, change in resistance is stable and reversible. Third type of problem is stability. Ceramic material is generally unstable, but our material is very stable and reversible for a long time, and after more than 1 to 2 years up to for application based material used in the lanthanum ferrite, very stable very long periods. Response time means time required to achieve 60 to 70% resistance of the base value, and recovery time required to reach the base value. From this easily understand from this graph, response percentage sensitivity, calculated selectivity, and optimizing temperature, response time, recovery time, response range, and stability. From this, in presence of air, material has resistance in mega ohm, 35 mega ohms. After sensing the gas, test gas is on, its resistance decreases, depends on the types of materials, N-type or P-type. And next slide, I will discuss the types of semiconductor materials, N-type or P-type. Generally, in N-type materials, for test gas is on, resistance decreases, and after gas is off, recover the same resistance. Recovery time, this time is called recovery time, and this time is called response time. Also, sensing mechanism, semiconducting oxide gas sensor shows a change in bulk or surface conductivity in presence of oxidizing or reducing gases, and change in conductivity can explain in terms of Fizi and chemiabsorption interactions. Fizi-absorption process is called is the phenomena. Van der Waal forces is responsible and exhibit sensitivity to a wide range of gases. Chemiabsorption process is strong interaction with the surface followed by bond formation, so an electron will transfer from bulk to adsorb gases. It will introduce a negative charge layer on the surface, consequently decrease in the surface conductivity by the formation of Schottky barrier. This is the formation of Schottky barriers in our lives. Here the oxygen and this mechanism in case of P adsorption, oxygen molecules and on the sensor surface call the oxygen layer on the surface layer O minus, and O minus is chemiabsorption process. When absorbed by P adsorption, adsorb and gives the electron. This electron is the take the conduction band and forms it from the depletion layer, takes the oxygen O minus and forms the after recovery after responding the oxygen electron oxygen O minus to recover the base resistance. There are two types of functions, receptor functions and transducer functions in the sensing surface. The receptor function depends on the surface area and porous nature and phase purity of particle size. But transducer function depends on the particle to particle contact to conduct the electrical signal generated during the gas adsorption and reabsorption process. Also on phase purity. Here, the reducing gases on takes the O minus from the surface form the oxide gases. For example, CO takes the O minus to form CO2 gas as a function of receptor function. We have discussed the materials N-type and P-type materials, semiconductor materials. N-type materials in reducing gases, it's for where resistance decreases, but in oxidizing gases, resistance increases, but in P-type material, resistance increases and for reducing gases and oxidizing in presence of oxidizing gases, resistance is decreases. Also, we'll discuss the surface. There are three types of diffusions: Knudsen diffusion, surface diffusion, Knudsen diffusion, molecular diffusion. The porosity is less than 2 nanometers. For the material, porosity is less than 2 nanometers. It occurs a surface diffusions, and 2 to 50 nanometers, it occurs a Knudsen diffusions. And after greater than 50 nanometers, molecular diffusion is takes place. Here, our material, this type of FSM structure, we show later on. Here is this is macro pores, and for primary particles, this is primary particles, and this is secondary particles. This is macro pores and mesoporous. This is a descriptive diagram for visualizing the easily understand the mechanism of semiconductor gas sensing. Here the sensor surface, after take the oxygens, increase the resistance. For our material is p-type, so resistance is increases, and after after desorption, resistance is decreases, and graph is formed. This type of graph is formed. This is mechanism is for n-type materials. Also, so the same mechanism from this oxygen traps the electron from conduction band due to strong electronegativity of oxygen atoms. Total charge carriers is dominated by hole due to depleted electron in the surface. In the CO and carbon monoxide takes the oxygen O minus to form CO2 plus electron. Electron and recombination of holes recombine the holes to form null. Due to the electron hole recombination, there is less number of carriers in the surface, so resistance is increased in the presence of gases. Now, this mechanism. I will discuss the synthesis and structural characterization for this material. Material characterization technique. You use the first of all phase macrostructural surface analysis. In this analysis, we have discussed about XRD, FSM, HRTM, XPS, and BET measurements. Spectroscopy analysis, we will discuss the FTIR and Raman, and other applications in gas sensing and catalytics, and next dielectric impedance and conductivity. Last is magnetic and magnetodielectric properties. We have prepared the sample in our lab from the solvent synthesis by modified Pacini process. Here the we take the our base material is lanthanum ferrite, and dropping the A side lead nitrate and B side cobalt nitrate, different ratio. Without and after base material also form lanthanum ferrite, or next material is lanthanum lead iron oxide, lanthanum lead iron cobalt oxides. Parameters to control particle size, optimal morphology, pH of precursors, temperature, citric acid to metal ratio, we have discussed acylation, citric acid in water dissolved, and mixed solution through ethylene glycols after the sonication to form a gel, after cell combustion to form the crystalline powder. This auto combustion method, mechanism is how lanthanum nitrate, iron nitrate, citric acid, ethylene glycol to mix through the chemical process. Here the auto combustion takes place. Is it visible? here the citric acid ethylene glycol takes the 3:1 ratio and added to the mixed precursor solution to form polymer metal cation network. Citric acid consists of three carboxyl group. It is a weak acid and easily decompose in aqueous solution to its conjugate base, which acts as a chelating agent to trap the cation of precursor material. In this process, cation are first bonded by citric acid, followed by a temperature-assisted hydrolysis reaction of citric acid with ethylene glycol to form an internal ester linkage. The complex precursor is stirred for 4 hours at 80 degrees centigrade and finally cooled down to room temperature to prepare lanthanum ferrite salt. In order to prepare lanthanum ferrite nanoparticles, the salt is dried for few hours at 120 degrees centigrade to prepare the liquid content and to produce a gel mass. The gel is heated at 140 degrees centigrade, 140 degrees centigrade until the autocombustion is initiated. The autocombustion process includes the decomposition and autocombustion of gel followed by the formation of dried lanthanum ferrite particles. The autocombustion is considered as a thermally induced redox reaction in which carboxyl group acts as reducing agent and nitrate ion plays the role oxidant. The phase formation next, the automated gas sensing measurement setup in our lab. Basically, this is semi-automatic gas sensing measurement setup. The gas delivery unit, the thermal stage, and the resistance measurement units are controlled by PC through RS-232 and GPIO interface using LabVIEW Technique 8.5 software for automatic process control. The data acquisition equipment are individually interfaced by PC. Here the electrometer used a Kithle GPIO interface, mass flow controller MKS automated through RS-232 interface, PID controller heater interface through RS-485 to RS-232 converter with a PC for temperature control and DAG card used. Gas delivery line with automated gas sensing, see gas delivery lines, automated resistance measurement setup and temperature control unit is here. This is catalytic measurement setup Neeri, Nagpur, and now in the lab, Dr. Nitin Lavaster, we have measured this sample for catalytic activity. Material characterization for electrical and dielectric properties in the lab, previous RNP sir lab, but in this period, Amrish Chandra lab is in Phoenix at IIT Kharagpur. Here we make the pellet for sensing purpose consigned at 400 degrees centigrade and 700 and 950 degrees centigrade. But for electrical measurement, we have sintered at 950 degrees centigrade for and at 4 compressors. This is a simple holder for the measurement of dielectric measurement. This is instrument for squid for magnetic measurement. Our multifunctional characteristic of lanthanum ferrite. First of all, we characterize the thermal analysis for identification. Thermal analysis. Here the TG curve shows the sample loss, the adsorbed species step by step, whole mass loss in temperature range. From room temperature to 700 centigrade is 8.6%. And DTA curve shows exothermic peak at 475, which will correspond to the mass loss in TG curve. The cation at the nascent surface that suffers from the incomplete coordination in oxygen ion
in polygon recovered upon the its light grow on heating the air. These two are exothermic peak at 280 degree centigrade and 475, which is the former peak may be due to the removal of organics, while the latter indicates the crystallization amorphous powder. This is published in our Jelcom in 2015. XRD. XRD pattern shows the lanthanum ferrite material as dried powder 400 and 700 and 950 calcine powder in different X-ray diffractogram, or also heat from foolproof methods, complete crystallization and pure phase materials formed from the retrieval analysis. We have calculated the lattice system crystallite size, lattice parameters, crystallite size, volume, density, and R factors also calculated from this retrieval analysis methods. Also, atoms atoms are lanthanum, iron, and oxygen, both O1 and O2, has X, Y, Z coordinates to be found from the LP analysis methods. Next, FTR spectroscopic measurement, FTR and Raman spectroscopy. In IR spectra, the strong absorption peak at 550 is attributed to the FeO stretching vibrations, metal oxide characteristics in FeO6 octahedra proboscide lanthanum ferrite, and absorption mode 1390 and 1495 per centimeter are assigned to be due to the splitting of the new three asymmetric stretching metal coordinate. The band 485 and 1080 per centimeter assigned to be new two and new one modes of metal carbonates. This is very useful in gas sensing mechanism. I will discuss the next slides. Same peaks are observed in the Raman spectroscopy also. Here the FSM HRTM image of lanthanum ferrite. This is very porous structures, primary and secondary particles shown in the in our samples. Also at after sintering, it is really compact in natures. Here the HRTM image shows the lattice planes, one-to-one planes, the main planes are shown in the figure. So acidity patterns for all crystalline planes. Here the BT measurements are here. BT absorption desorption isotherm shown in figure at 700 degrees Celsius calcined lanthanum ferrite materials order correspond to type 4 isotherms with S3 type of isotherms. We know from the journals we find the types of absorption isotherm are 6 types and types of hysteresis loop are 4 types. So our material is type 4 isotherms and with S3 type of hysteresis it formed. Now the nature of hysteresis can be calculated by S3 type, which signifies a mesoporous borders. The shows monomodal pore size distribution. Pore size distribution area is 30.8 meter square per gram. Or average pore diameter is 10.1. Calculated from this formula. XPS analysis. From the XPS analysis, we find the binding energy of the oxygen and iron iron 2 plus and iron 3 plus. The oxygen adsorption. Deconverted bands from lanthanum ferrite calcined at 700 degrees centigrade. The oxygen ONS band is at 529.2 electron volt is attributed to the lattice oxygen OL and 531.5 is the oxygen adsorption band. It forms surface the surface hydroxyl group and carbonate like species. Similarly, I have the in Fe2 plus and Fe3 plus binding energy is this is at the 710 electron volt and 724.1 electron volt. Now the application of gas sensing mechanism for CO gas sensing characteristics.
छोड़े तो नहीं खाओ और तुम ही खा ले और आज ही सब खत्म हो जाता
है. Here the three characteristics of metallic activity of activity of proboscide surface is takes place interfacial process and superficial process or surface components. Superficial process occurs here in gas sensing mechanism. I have p type semiconductors. P-type materials for gas sensing. After sensing the CO, increases the resistance and at 1660 ppm. After changing the ppm, 10,000 ppm, decrease the sensing of decrease the sensing percentage response for base for the lanthanum ferrite at 300 degrees centigrade, operating temperature is 300 degrees centigrade. For but after doping the p-site cobalt for 20%, its operating temperature is decreases for decrease at 175 degrees centigrade. So we can from see the graph, you can see that the gas concentration changing the gas concentration decreases the response percentage, or and after doping the cobalt. Decreases the operating temperatures. A linear fit of is obtained in the log-log plot in the inbox between the resistance and gas concentration. It is interesting to note that excellent CO sensing characteristics are obtained using LFCO for doping cobalt 20% sensing element. At temperature as low as 175 degrees centigrade. In the test gas concentration in the range of 10 to 10,000 ppm for lanthanum iron cobalt oxide, sensing element in better cobalt better CO response at lower test gas concentration as compared to lanthanum ferrite. We will discuss from the FTR for lanthanum ferrite in the range 800 to 1800 per centimeter or LFCO lanthanum iron cobalt oxide FTR spectra in the same range. We have seen that nanocrystalline of lanthanum iron cobalt oxide sensor is capable to sense 10 ppm CO at 100 degrees centigrade. The sensor is completely selective to CO sensing at low temperature, less than 125 degrees centigrade. The selectivity from this figure we see here, in the LFCO at low temperature, 125, less than 125, also sense the of about 35 to 40% sensing for CO gases. After dropping the cobalt, it is very selective in nature. The selectivity characteristic is correlated to the superior catalytic activity of this perovskite towards CO oxidation. The lower metal oxygen binding energy, favorable d orbital electron configuration of transition metal cation. Since we know that iron and cobalt is the d orbital electronic configuration, here the metal oxygen binding energy changes, and nature of surface composition are dominant factors that controls the catalytic activity and thereby CO sensing characteristics. Selectivity coefficient of LFCO sensor were estimated to be 9.25 to 10 ppm hydrogen and 3.5 to 10 ppm butane. So it is very selective in nature for CO sensing. This mechanism from chemistry background, we have designed scripting diagram for TG and T2G mechanism for one-way unpaired electron is present in DZ2, which goes to the antibonding orbital for BO bond, ABO3 structure. In ABO3 structure, B and O bond, when O minus comes and binds to the cobalt 3 plus center, hence the bond is weak and adsorbs CO molecules get oxidized easily. The catalytic activity increased with a decrease in BO bond strength. A weaker bond strength seems to be more favorable for increasing the reactivity of surface oxygen species in catalytic activity. We see the binding energy decreases, activity increases. Now we calculate this formula with an oxygen bond. Here the CO oxidation activity, function of temperature of lanthanum ferrite for different types of compositions, LFO, LPFCO, LPFO, LFCO, and LPFCO for gas sensing, catalytic activity, CO conversions, and response percentage. We see that LFCO is a low temperature, about 175 degrees centigrade. Other materials are very high temperature sensing and also low responses. Our other materials, base materials, lanthanum ferrite, is selective for butane sensing gas mechanism, gas sensing. But in LFCO, we just discussed for the CO sensing selectivity. But here the lanthanum ferrite is the butane sensing selective. Butane is the main constituent of LPG, 1.9% lower explosive limit by volume in air. The improved butane sensing characteristics due to their efficient catalytic nature towards butane oxidation. K value selectivity for LFO butane sensor was estimated to be 1.67 and 4.67 for 50 ppm H2 and CO. The oxidative deionization of butane initiated by the removal of the hydrogen atom by the molecular oxygen is favored at lower temperature, whereas the thermal cracking of butane initiated by the C-C bond is favored relatively at higher temperatures. Here the see that for the calcination also see that calcining different temperatures of lanthanum ferrite 400, 700, and 950 degrees centigrade, we have measured the different sample for response percentage. We see that the at 700 degrees centigrade is the maximum response at 90%, but for 400 it is not complete crystallized, but after the hitting the 950, it will more compact but not porous, so it will sense very low at calcination at 950 degrees centigrade. He published in the Sensor FFLB at 2015. This mechanism shows from the FTIR spectra spectra. Here the thermal cracking, the acidic sensor surface favors low temperature cracking of vulcan. Because at low wave number, here the carbonate atoms is present there. So acidic sensor surface favors low temperature cracking of vulcans. Thermal oxidative deionization, the abstraction of the hydrogen atom from the N-butan by oxygen, is called thermal oxidation of deionization. And catalytic oxidative deionization, catalytic activity is due to the presence of surface absorbed oxygen species and hydroxyl ions dissolved water and oxygen molecule initiate the catalytic oxidative deionization of butanes. Here the different samples, lanthanum ferrite, 20% lead drop and 20% cobalt drop. See the sensing mechanism. Since the base resistance in air decreases, sensitivity decreases due to the shrinkage of potential barrier, that is less number of oxygen is can result. So the number of oxygen decreases at the surface. So here this is at lead side dropping. Sensing mechanism, sensing response is very low. But in cobalt doping, you see that sensing response is very high and also selective images. Now, next application is electrical characterizations. For electrical characterizations, impedance spectroscopy basic mechanism is there. The electrical response of material present measured by the following mechanism formula: complex impedance, complex admittance, complex modulus, dielectric constant, loss tangents. From this formula, AC conductivity and the gran capacitance, gran boundary capacitance, all are interrelated with each other. Equivalent circuit modeling is there. This is shows the Z double prime versus Z prime circuit diagram. Model is, we have low frequency electrode material interface is there. Here is the resistance of gran boundary and electrodes is there. But intermediate frequency, okay, here is the gran boundary effect is there. And at high frequency, gran effect is here. This circuit model is for the this mechanism. Here the bulk property, gran R and C circuit, and for the gran boundary and the electrode interface. This is so understand very easily from the this book, Leibovitz. Impedance spectroscopy application to electrochemical and dielectric phenomena. Here the see the model, three types of model: Maxwell, Voggit and Leder. Semicircle is called Maxwell or Leder. Hierarchical Leders, Randall and series is Voggit type of mechanism is there. The hierarchical Leder network representation of this system ensures that bulk processes are present at the highest frequency, followed by the interfacial impedance arc representing charge transfer, double layer diffusion, and adsorption process at the high frequency. Voggit circuitry does not impose the limitation. Diffusion may occur anywhere in the diagram. However, they almost always are either at the lowest frequency. This circuit diagram for Maxwell, Leder, and Voggit. This is our sample result. Here at high frequency, the high frequency depressed semicircle correspond to the bulk conduction, and here the intermediate frequency semicircle correspond to the conduction across the gran boundary. We have fitted from the jet symbol. Here the circuit is R and constant phase element Q. For the formula, C is equal to R and Q radiation. For N equal to 1, Q capacitor, or N equal to 0 for Q resistors. The constant phase element used for the optimal deviation of capacitance from ideal behavior. We have to calculate the temperature variation of the sample and calculate the different types of. In our sample, polaron types of mechanism is there. So what is polaron? In lanthanum ferrite, oxygen ion are present both in plus 2 and plus 3 valence state. Interaction between the charge carriers, means primary holes, and these ions distort the lattice and induce polarization. As a consequence, position of the ions may be shifted slightly to balance the effect of these forces. Hello, Anshu. Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir. Ha,
Tabarak ji.
Yes, sir.
Are you audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
Okay.
Go on.
Okay. The combination of charge carriers and the induced polarization is known as, it's called polarons. Polaron. And the polarization induced by the charge carrier is large, larger than the cell parameter. It needs special extension. Then the polaron is termed as large polaron. And the polaron effect produced by the charge around it is confined to a region comparable to the cell dimension. The resulting first particles is known as small polarons. For the in our sample, small polarons is there in our sample. This formula for conductivity measurement for gamma equal to 1. This is for adiabatic and 1.5 for non-adiabatic nature. I will discuss them later. We'll find from the activation energy of the WH plus binding energy of holes and oxygen. This our materials is very colloidal dielectric constant. Colloidal means high dielectric constant at low frequency, but high frequency may vary. Low dielectric constants. Origin of collision dielectric constant is the region electrode polarization due to an interface barrier between the electrode and the specimen. Second is Maxwell-Wegener type of polarization due to the heterogeneity in the system. Third is bulk effect. This is the example for literature survey. And in yttrium ferrite and niobium ferrite also show the collision dielectric constant. This polarity shows the variation of frequency. This type of polarization is there: space charge polarization, dipole polarization, ionic polarization, and electron polarization. This this paper is published in JAP 2014. So have the dielectric constant versus frequency. So the dielectric constant is wide temperature range. Is very well correlated to polaronic conduction of bulk grain. Polaronic conduction is also prevailing in grain boundary region. The dielectric permittivity of grain exhibit maximum at 410, whereas the grain boundary permittivity increases with temperature. Dielectric versus dielectric permittivity versus temperature, dielectric constant versus temperature are similar to ferroptic ceramics. This shows similar to the ferroptic ceramics. However, for this material is centrosymmetric point groups, dipolar polarization is not expected. But ferroptic polarization occur in non-centrosymmetric point groups. Here, the lanthanum ferrite centrosymmetric point groups, but see the ferroptic nature is there. Calculate the capacitance of grain and grain boundary. So, hello.
Bhargav sir. Yes, sir. Please conclude also, now. We are running also, late, sir.
Yes, sir.
Bhargav sir.
Also, P-loop measurement for hysteresis, room temperature, P-loop is lanthanum ferrite and LFCO is thought to be due to the cantate spin of bus 5 minutes or center spin of
okay sir
P3 plus spin induced polarization ordering due to the charge ordering between iron 2 plus and iron 3 plus ions. This hysteresis loop do not saturate at the higher electric field due to the low grain resistance. The loop resembles those recorded from the leaky ferroptic capacitors. after power dropping conduction low resistance, so conducting mechanism is there, so lossy loop is there occur. Now my last last multifunctional property is magnetic and magnetodielectric characterizations. Our sample base material is magnetic properties is there. Length and flight exhibit antiferromagnetic coupling where the antiparallel Fe3+ ion interact via the intervening oxygen ions. For the lanthanum ferrite, lanthanum 3+ ion do not have localized magnetic movement. The spin configuration of iron 3+ ion are type 4 types. Due to the canting, the spin moment in two sublattices are not completely concealed and yield small ferromagnetic moment along C-axis of the unit cell. So appearance of weak ferromagnetism is there in lanthanum ferrite can therefore explain to be there due to anti-symmetric EM type of exchange interaction. The canted spin structure gives rise to the weak ferromagnetism at low temperature below 25 degrees centigrade. The magnetic behavior is dominated by the random freezing of the surface spin explained by the large number of coercivity and remanence polarized remanence magnetization. The kink mark is the other ones have the ZFCFC observed in ZFCFC plot about 735 indicates the interferometric to paramagnetic mean temperature. I below the temperature is shows the spin glass behavior. Also the materials this work is published in Journal of Nanoscience and Technology. This material is LPFC both sides of doping lead and cobalt. Here the huge is very high magnetization is there at low temperature. As R changes, only mutual position of oxygen octahedra changes, then change in bond angle of FeO valence bond, which affect nil temperature. As a distortion due to the doping of the weak cation. Since the FeFe and FeO distances do not show large changes, the increase in FeO bond angle increases the overlap between the FeO atomic orbital and leads to the strong super exchange interaction between FeFe. TB is the temperature, blocking temperature, which at which magnetic anisotropy energy barriers of the nanoparticle is overcome by the thermal activation and nanoparticles become super paramagnetically relaxed. And here the see that at room temperature, we show the super paramagnetic behaviors. Below TB, sample shows weak ferromagnetic in the vicinity of TB. The sample exhibit typical super paramagnetic characteristic and TN at 720 kelvins, antiferromagnetic to paramagnetic nature reflected. Here the magnetodielectric coupling percentage is calculated for the different samples. And we calculate the value of epsilon zero increases with the increase of the applied magnetic field, which indicate the existence of positive coupling between magnetic and electric order parameter in the sample at room temperature. The presence of antiferromagnetic and ferroelectric coupling, that is multiferric state in all the samples. Summary and conclusions. We have defined the auto combustion synthesis is efficient to make nanocrystalline lanthanum ferrite and its cation drop varieties. All synthesis powder are were characterized X-ray and detailed refinement to be pure phase pure. These powders are further characterized by the electron microscopy FTIR, microdomain, BET absorption, isotherm, and XPS analysis to better understand their dielectric, ferroelectric, magnetic, magnetoelectric, catalytic, and biosensing material properties. The temperature dependence of dielectric constant of pure lanthanum ferrite exhibits dielectric maximum similar to the observed in ferroelectric ceramic and non-centrosymmetric point groups. The dielectric relaxation of lanthanum ferrite correlates well with small polaron conduction. The canting of the Fe3+ ion also induced weak ferromagnetism in nanocrystalline lanthanum ferrite. The magnetoelectric coupling in the system has been demonstrated through the magnetodielectric measurement, which yield about 0.8% electric tuning at 10 kilohertz with the application of 2 Tesla magnetic field. Addition of non-magnetic lead and magnetic cobalt material dopant about 20% atomic percent makes the modified length of ferrite. So that the collisional dielectric constant type ceramics, the CDC characteristic have found to be much more prominent in both lead and cobalt doped lanthanum iron oxides, LPFC ceramics. Room temperature segregation magnetization of pure lanthanum ferrite reported to be 3 AME per gram. This has been grossly improved in LPFC ceramics about 10 AME per gram. The modified lanthanum ferrite ceramics with CDC characteristics do not exhibit polarization hysteresis characteristic, mostly due to the increased leakage current density. The magnetic tunneling tuning in LPFC ceramic reported to be 60% at 10 kilohertz with the application of 2 Tesla magnetic field. The efficient reducing gas sensing characteristic of lanthanum ferrite based orthofluorides have been correlated in their catalytic activity towards oxidation and reducing gases, test gases as butane, carbon monoxide, methane, and hydrogen sensing. Through FTIR analysis, we would detect surface absorbed oxygen species on the perovskite structure. Thank you for kind references. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. K.K. Bhargav. Thank you very much. If you allow, I will share your email in chat box because we are running late. So participants, if they want to ask questions, they will send to your email and you will answer later. So are you allowing me?
Yes.
Okay, thank you, sir. Doctor, you talked about what the nanostructured materials are. You also talked about the types of nanostructured materials.
Yes.
You explained the basic structure of perovskites, about multifunctional materials, what are the multifunctional properties. You also talked about gas sensors, what is the need of gas sensor, their significance. You talked about gas sensing parameters. You also talked about sensing mechanism, function of sensors, different types of synthesis methods and characterization techniques like impedance spectroscopic techniques you have talked. So I think your talk is very valuable to all the participants who is participating. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much,
Bhargav
sir.
Thank you.
Anal sir's talk is still left, so now I request Dr. Anal Kant Jha sir for rest of his talk.
Yes. Thank you. Okay. I'm just trying to. Just Bhargav ji will have to remove the slides. Then I will commence my lecture.
Right. Okay.
Thank you.
Stop presenting.
So,
yes.
Bhargav, please leave your.
Yes, Bhargav sir has left.
Present now for the entire screen. There. Is the slide visible to you all? No?
No, sir.
Okay.
It's still not coming. Present now, then your entire screen you should do.
I am doing that.
And then in icon, then a picture of our desktop is coming. Click on that.
Yes.
And then share.
Yes. Your picture or my picture? What? Which one?
Yes. A picture of full desktop.
Yes. I clicked that.
Then share. Then share.
Share, okay, fine. Share. Is the slide coming? No?
No, sir, not coming. Start from the big. Yes. Now coming.
Now
it is coming.
It's now coming.
Is it there?
Oh, yes, sir. Now go to your slide, sir. Go to your presentation.
Okay.
presentation. Go to full screen.
Yes, sir. Yes, now coming. Make it full screen, sir.
Yes. Trying to do that. It's a heavy file. Is now full screen or not?
Yes, sir. Now it's fine. Yes. Okay. It's processing.
So I was here.
Yes.
I was here somewhere. Yes, I was here. So I've been picking up the strings right from that point, that it is nature. Nature is nothing but it is manifestation of thermodynamics and supramolecular chemistry. And from smaller bits of growth of a leaf, of a flower, bird, leaf bird or flower bird, phool ki kali ho, patte ki kali, kali ka ho, ya development of bone, regeneration of bone, or the regeneration of skin, repair of capillaries, dissolution of blood clots, is all these things are obeyed by Dawab mentioned principles, that is the principle of supramolecular chemistry, dynamics. We must remember at this point that physics is the pivot, chemistry is the reason of nature, and the entire nature is manifested. Slowly we will realize this, because nature is amazing. It has unique conglomerate of unicellular prokaryotes, those structures who have lacked in developing their nuclei properly. Those who have done it successfully are eukaryotes. Among plants and animal kingdoms, it has a unicellular alga and giant vines and tree fern. I think I'm audible to all of you.
Yes, sir, you are audible. Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yes, it has simple amoeba. It has simple amoeba and amoeba histolytica that causes us dysentery. Plasmodium causes malaria. Hydra also causes it. Some forms are pathogenic. Many mammalian, complex mammalian bodies like that of whale, that of buffalo or a human body. Mother Nature is full of such amusements. Why these things are amusing? Among all these, one thing is common. Their basic constitution and adaptability that has been the raw material for their exponential evolution. Evolution is an exponential process. And it says that those who change will remain. Those who adapt will remain. Otherwise, they will get fossilized or eliminated from the rail, from the trail of evolution. The net metabolite contents of different organisms, which bestow them the adaptability, the beauty of adaptability, and their individual metabolic processes, the chemical intricate biochemical processes, is we call them fluxes. They make them unique in the cell, because only that has led to such a big, large plethora of organisms on the canvas of nature. Life as such is an interesting story of inorganic structure. System, vice versa. We will realize in subsequent slides. So the crux, the basic point, the very basic point is natural cohorts against their organizational endeavor, taking use of organic materials for various purposes. And this indeed led to the development of a myriad of organic structures and subsequently the living. Ionic balance at cellular level is still maintained, and this justifies the existence and importance of chemistry in our day-to-day life. So here we come to the, because the time is limited, so I will go a bit fast with your kind permission. So here, bio-nanoscience, once the life sees towards nanoscience and nanoscience sees towards life science, it's bio-nanoscience. And by taking these two into consideration, a technology which is developed is bio-nanotechnology. So in which we take use of benign microbes, those microbes which are beneficial, which are edible. And in that category comes lactobacilli and yeast. Use of plant specimens, use of plant parts, organs, other members of the plant kingdom, expiry medicines, pharmaceutical wastes, organic or biological wastes. We all involve the biosphere, living or non-living, but I will take care of only living things in my talk, because it will just broaden the horizon of this talk. I will avoid that part, but I'll just try to justify why life is linked and how life is linked to nanoscience and technology, and how it is beneficial and what are the limitations. Bio-nanotechnology is what? Nanotechnology, what we know, great deal we have defined it. It is engineering and manufacturing of nanometer scales, material of nanometer scales with atomic precision. Biotechnology harnesses biological processes and uses them for our own applications. Bio-nanotechnology is a subset of nanotechnology. Atom level engineering and manufacturing using biological precedents for the guidance. That's what bio-nanotechnology is, I think. So in just in this slide, I would like to see the quickly I would like to show that what are the contributory fields: material science, microbiology, biochemistry, biotechnology, bioprocess engineering, and at the base, we have physics. What we do have? We have consumer beneficiaries, Professor Prashad. Device applications. We can do, because earlier people used to say that the plant metabolites, the animal metabolites might interfere. No, they do not interfere. You can purify them through affinity chromatography and make them, take them into the purest form for device applications. Real issues are what? Why living systems are to be? The thing is, bacteria can synthesize nanomaterials. It was the first time in IIT Madras when Thalapil Pradeep had synthesized silver intracellularly. And then many other people throughout the world did that. There is the group at NCL. There was a group, I must say.
There are no slides, sir. There are no slides are visible.
No visible slide?
Okay, listen. There are two Analkant Jha in your paper list. Please tap the presentation tab. Please tap Analkant Jha presentation. There are two tabs.
Should I get back to the presentation now?
Yes, sir. You can proceed.
So, full screen. Okay, so these are the real issues. We will try to be as brief as possible. What are the biochemical processes leading to nanoparticle?
Please make it full screen.
I did that.
Yes.
Now it's okay.
Yes, sir. Now so okay.
People did it. People earlier did it intracellularly, but myself and we tried to develop our own mechanism for extracellular synthesis. And then we tried to relieve the biochemical processes leading to nanoparticle formation. Why a living system should be? Whether it is a prokaryote, a bacteria, lactobacillus, what we take every day, or the fungus, developed fungus, Saccharomyces cerevisiae, yeast, amoeba, why should it give? Can we extend the methodologies to other chemical compositions like sulfur, oxide, even higher oxides? Is size control possible? Can we achieve better monodispersity? How about nanoparticle shape modulation? Can we achieve that? So these were the core issues. And once we got it matured in terms of methodology, we got it, perceived this idea that can we extend it to plant parts, plants, its acts, roots, and other. And if once we got the plants, they answered that yes, we can give you nano, then we switched over to animal system. Then we took over another thing, that is expired medicine or the domestic wastes, that is kitchen waste. We will show, we really know it in subsequent slides. Now these are the answers. I will be a bit quick in this section. So here you can see synthesis of CDS nanoparticles using yeast and lactobacilli. You can see lactobacilli, this is yeast, you know. You can see the type of peaks we have got, broadening, marvelous broadening we have got. So this says that yes, living system can participate. One thing, our most exciting slide is this one. Here we had taken use of Saccharomyces cerevisiae yeast, and we had gone up to this point, you know, 0.667 to 6.99 nanometers. That is the angstrom range, 6.7 angstrom. It was possible. It was done in the chemistry department. and you can see the broadening of peak. System is ready, and these are the explanations. They have weaponry. They have weaponry to shear the assault metallic. And as a result of that, we get the nanomaterial. We must not forget that nanoscience is the hammer of a goldsmith. It is not hammer of a blacksmith. Hammer is taken used by both of them. But it is the precision which matters, which actually culminates in the synthesis. That's what we have pondered and came up to this conclusion. Here are the examples, TiO2 nanoparticles, barium titanate nanoparticles. Are the characterizations, and these are the this is TEM, XRD, and other things. I'll proceed further. The one is taken use of synthesized. I'm sorry, we have both are synthesized of use of this azosaccharomyces cerevisiae and lactic acid. Yet now I deliver little bit about why lactobacilli should basically give the nanopathy. Well, lactobacilli, like most of the bacteria, have a negative electrokinetic potential, which really attracts the cations, and this probably acts as the crux of procedure of biosynthesis. Addition of reducing agents like glucose tends to lower the value of oxidation reduction potential. The oxidation reduction potential expresses the quantitative character of degree of aerobiosis, having a designated unit expressed at RH2. The negative logarithm of the partial pressure of gaseous hydrogen. Lactobacillus bacteria as such are gram positive, functionally related by their ability to produce lactic acid, homo or hetero fermentive carbohydrate metabolism. So we are at win at every stage. This intermediate is pyruvate, lactate. This pyruvate enters the aerobic cycle. Otherwise, it just basically fatigues. Most of the time, lactate is formed in our muscles, and we get fatigued. And we will be surprised to know pyruvate is not the food of cancer cells. Lactate is the food of cancer. As and when there is a detection of cancer, we get higher level of lactate. So here, further chemistry of that is that nature of lactic acid is such that it is stereoisomeric, both L and D form. In addition to optical activity, the lactic acid molecule has simultaneous carboxylic and hydroxyl group. This bestows it with a unique property of to act either an acid or as an alcohol. So the dual functionality, what we discussed, initiates spontaneous formation from intramolecular esters, oligomers, with discharge of water leading to a thermodynamic equilibrium subject to solution concentration and age. And that is in your control. You can do it in the lab, and we had done that. Depending upon the type of material, we tend to synthesize, project to synthesize. So thermodynamically, the heat of dissociation amounts to 63 calorie per mole at room temperature. And the value of free energy of dissociation of lactic acid, 5,000 calorie per mole per minute. This probably ensures availability of energy in the culture solution along with other crux metabolites, leading to a successful nanotransformation. That will be the story of fungi. I think I'm sorry, I'm not being. Is it visible to you all? No.
Yes, sir. Visible.
Okay. So in fungi, we see in the center we have yeast. This side is Aspergillus. This is Fusarium, and these are the conglomerates of events which take place. It will become really out of context here due to the wide range of audience. So, but in nutshell, I would like to explain that this is outer form. Outer cell has quinones. Inner one is ready to have such a large and big, well-developed weaponry of metabolites to shear the metallic stress. And that's why we get metal, oxide, or chalcogenide, depending upon the modulation of the culture media, the nourishment, and the temperature. This is our game. It is completely in our control to get what kind of material we want to synthesize and what kind of monodispersity we want to. So that is the thing. Now we switch over to plant parts. Everybody must have come across this common plant, Bhringraj. Bhringraj is a powerful medicine. And we had taken use of Bhringraj extract, alcoholic extract, to synthesize the silver. This was one of the earliest work we had done using plant system. And most exciting is nanogold from Bilvapatra. We all know Bilvapatra was consumed by Mata Parvati to get Shiva, Lord Shiva. It has three leaves, three leaflets. And Ayurveda says the Bilvapatra is Tridosh Nasa, Rajasvatottama Guna. Tridosh Nasa. And people had, we had this technology in Nalanda University by Nagarjuna. He had believed and explored and explained in Rasratanakar that we can synthesize a gold from plant extract. Well, unfortunately, that got destroyed. But one more is there, Ark Prakash by Ravan, Lankapati Ravan. That also details this. And we had done that much earlier in 2010-11 by taking hint from such scriptures and by constant encouragement from Professor Prasad. We could do it, and we have got it in a very, very low dimension. It has tremendous use, potential use in the different type of application, biomedical application. You can see the candidate metabolites here. We tried to decipher why it is happening. We must be able to answer. Otherwise, science becomes journalism. To just explain, to emphasize, we took the three category of plants. One is xerophyte. One is xerophyte. Xerophyte are those plants which grow in arid zone, dry zone, desert areas. They don't need much water. One is common cypress, motha. Another one is hydrilla, which is very, very common in freshwater pond, beaches, and all give you silver. And we had tried to reason why it is happening, and we had also deciphered the probable mechanism. And we got it published in 2009. And I'm proud to say that it has 375 citations till date. So next one, this work is also extension of that. This is work. This work was undertaken by my student, Babita. Silver, platinum, and gold using clove of Allium sativum, lahsun. You can see all the things, and these are all anti-cancerous. Similarly, Ponica generatum, aerials, anar, bedana. You can see gold, platinum, silver. You can see gold, platinum, silver from piper betel, palm. All are anti-cancers, lung cancer. They are active against lung cancer cell lines. They are active cell lines, testicular cancer cell lines, in vitro. So again, this is when old, but you know, it's really very fascinating work. We had taken use of rose petals to get gold nanoparticles, and it was reasoned like this, that these are the candidate metabolites which facilitate the synthesis. That is important. You can make out now from flower to fruit to this orange juice. Orange juice gave us a nanoparticle, silver as well as zinc oxide. It contains hesperidine, it contains ascorbic acid, redox reaction of ascorbic acid that gives you. It has citric acid. Citric acid. Tick very quickly.
Sir, your voice is not coming. Anal sir?
It could be Amana's experience in Pudina. Alkaloids are present in nicotine, alkaloids are present in natura,
steroids, or many others, non-flavonoids, tannins, still beans, thiocyanates, etc. They all participate. They contribute. So other potential plant sources would be lichens, mycorrhiza. These are broadly unexplored, but you know, a few of my students have done work on pteridophytes, and we have, myself and Kamalji, have done work on gymnosperms. Here are a few results I have tried to show you for feeling right to show you. So let us skip these slides just to not to waste your time. So we come straight away to the kitchen waste. You know, this is potato peel. You can see Mugdha, one of my students at home. Yes, submitted it. Potato peel can give you silver. Then orange peel, this is exemplification only. Orange peels, they give you silver. So these, I'm trying to say that these things can do miracles for us, because you know, once you prepare silver from this one, solanine, the alkaloid from this, so it could be a very good cure against second degree or first degree burn in the kitchen. And this is also very good. Orange peel is a very good medicine of venous ulcer, diabetic foot. So now we come to a point whether animals can contribute. Can banana fly, cockroaches, mosquitoes, ants, slaughterhouse pests, fish dressings, chicken dressings, and do. Why we try to do that? Because you know, these slaughterhouse wastes or just fish dressing, they are bringing new viruses in the system, because they are festering proteins. There are organisms with novel nucleic acids. They get encapsulated, and they are airborne and cause diseases. So we took Periplaneta americana to synthesize this, you know, and a metal, an oxide, and a chalcobinite. All the three were synthesized by us, and this work was nominated for IG Nobel Prize in 2013. We missed, myself, Kamal Ji and me, marginally we missed that, no problem. But the work was extended to banana fly, and we got quantum dot from that. So further, we didn't stop. We took Culex mosquitoes, common mosquitoes, and we got this, you know, TDS nanoparticles. Can we imagine that the mosquito vests can give you quantum dots? This is the beauty, how life and you know, nano are interrelated, because smaller of the organism, smaller is the assembly. It is very close to its scale. And you bring them into contact, and you get the material. That's it. So here, pre-processing discovery. Again, we got the IGNPs. They're all published works. So this one, you know, slaughterhouse goat, slaughtered goat best. That means this is what we got come across the intestines. We took little bit of that, and then we talk. We just make the extract, took the extract, and got this zinc oxide nanoparticles. Why did we do that? Because it is a beautiful, it's a wonderful antimicrobial material. It checks the fall order. And there are many other beautiful things. We cannot apply it over our face, but we can spread them into drains, of course. We can do. And moreover, this is also a route to suggest that, well, look, we can do something about these biological waste. The next one is our, the very brief what we have contributed. So we have prepared a wound healer dressing lotion that is bio nano composite material. It is a bit effective against deep cuts, wounds, viral attacks, herpes simplex, psoriasis, nail keratosis, second degree burn, and osteomyelitis. It may also act as antiseptic germicidal if suitably diluted, can function as an office lotion. We can't go into examples because, you know, restriction of time is there. Most of us are tired and maybe hungry, of course.
So I'm getting to a new idea, sharing a new idea by taking use of the above notion, tentatively called Curion Plus. We call it Curion. We are in the math, I mean, in the procedure of getting them patented and then commercialized. Nanomaterial based black bodies. I don't believe in the theory of nanorobot because there is a lot of hazard in that. So we have developed the idea of nano-based black bodies to eliminate diseases like dengue, malaria, encephalitis, chikungunya, osteomyelitis, tuberculosis of bone, and a few types of cancer. What we call bio-orthogonal nanotechnology. This is our concept, myself and company, bio-orthogonal nanotechnology. So if once we achieve that, by grace of God, then we will have something new in nanoscience and technology. So point is, how far can we go? Can we have nano tablets? Can we have nano syrup? No, not at all. We cannot do that. And solid issue is long-term toxicity. How they are going to deal with the harm? How they are going to how they are going to behave to our immune system cells, macrophages. Then, second one is, if even if they get completely deposited in kidney, in liver, in muscle, what will be the fate? So we need to have a biomarker library for that. What will be the manifestations? What will be the symptomatology? What will be the etiology? What will be the treatments? Science. In a mice, it is fine, but how much signal penetration will take place? It will carry in human specimens a big question. Moreover, how do they behave in the space? Once you are in the periphery, they are in the system. How do they behave in the 3D spatial resolution? And what will be the fate? And last one is success in human trials. This is the excitement actually gets quenched a bit over here because we need to do more science in this area. Challenges are very, very interesting challenges. Multiple modalities we need. And we need functional nanoparticle, target-oriented nanoparticles, high stress tendency of nanoparticles to be absorbed by reticulo into endothelial system. I know most of the people will not perceive this term reticulo-endothelial system. The system is that we have a running bead of capillaries all through our body. Once it is taken inside, like the Ayurvedic bhakti, once it is taken inside, then how will it respond? That is a big thing. And retention time is very, very important. How much? The way we take antibiotic, any antibiotic, it has a plasma peak. Can we do that? Have we done that? No, we haven't done that. So, can it eliminate the potentially toxic elements or just it make a chelate? It will make complicated complexes. This is also a big issue. And once you take anything inside, it is bound to trigger an immunoinflammatory and immune response. And moreover, can it be useful in detecting the deep-seated tumors, not the superficial tumors? These are the basically big questions and the challenges before nanoscience and technology. At the moment, if you are trying to spread our wings in the area of biomedicine. Finally, I would like to say, if you are talking in terms of life system, so I'm getting back to the issue that the metabolic status of an organism is important. Life is important. But if you know the chemistry, you can get a very good plethora of nanomaterials. Reactive response in terms of signal transduction at molecular level seemingly is operative in case of microbes, which could vary according to the organism type, prokaryote or eukaryote. It is a very technical term, but I'm sorry. I would like to dilute it just to make you understand. The thing is, once you take something, it has a fate. Once you bring the microbe or the living system in contact of any metal ion or a solution, it is bound to react. Will be the pathway. That is very important. It has been partially been it has partially been done so far. It has been done partially so far. But we need to scale longer heights in that. A lot of things are there to be done. Plant specimens, we have discussed that. And then metabolic treasure is always there, always there. You need to discuss, we need to know the metabolic treasure, how do they behave, what is their thermodynamic fate, how will they behave to a pH change, a temperature change, whatever. While using organic waste or expired medicine, a slightly different cue will be applicable. I have not discussed due to limitation of time. Rest is dependent upon the modulating parameters, that is pH, temperature, and the nutrients. This is in your control. If you control all the three, you can control the monodose dispersity of the material, whether it's a metal, it is an oxide, higher oxide, a chalcedonite. So nature never fails to deliver. So living system and nano system are just friends, hand to hand. They are always responding to each other. All we need to do is to have a better perspective. Well, such a big work cannot be possible without big people. I have been blessed with two professors, collaborators, my childhood friend, Professor Kamal Prasad, and Professor A.R. Kulkarni. They have been great support of this project, to this project. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. And any further questions, most welcome.
Thank you very much.
Most welcome.
Dr. Dhanakar Thakur.
I think yes, I have.
Dr. Dhanakur, yes, yes. Dhanakar Thakur is in participant side. He want to interact with you directly, perhaps. Dr. Thakur, are you listening to me? Dr. Dhanakar Thakur, please unmute yourself. Dr. Thakur, or if any other participants have any question, then please unmute themselves, and you can also turn on your video and ask the questions directly to Dr. Jha, or you can put it in chat box.
Yes,
or you can put it in chat box too. Dr. Dhanakar Thakur was having some observations regarding bio nanoscience and nanotechnology, the use of nanotechnology in medicine. Dr. Dhanakar Thakur is present, but he is not listening. So please ask the questions if anyone have any question. Dr. Islam.
Listening me? I am Dhanakar Thakur.
Yeah. Dr. Thakur.
Listening.
Welcome.
Dr. Jha has presented very many good things about nanotechnology.
Stop your presentation first. Anand sir, please stop your presentation.
Yes. Stop sharing. Yes, sir.
Deserves all congratulations because he has presented how the nanotechnology can be used to medical sciences. And though we are using it, but there is great vista on which it can be used, like Ayurveda and the metals and toxins and the planata. They have cockroach, they are told. It has also base of many allergies, immunologies, then the drug delivery systems. It can be made many drugs, many newer drugs can become through mucopolysaccharides and the metal and toxins. I think the plant can be plant life, the Ayurvedas, they can be taken into nanotechnology, their delivery system. And as Dr. Jha has told, kapha bath pitta. So that is not Trigun. Trigun is sat rajitam. That is different thing. But
yeah, that's what I had said, sir.
Many other.
And that's what I had said, Satura. Yes, sir. Anyway, carry on, sir.
Those which are used, they can be used in other way. And the nanotechnology, as an engineering science, so that can be, human body is the biggest engineering science. So yes, there, on the enzymes and delivery system, drug delivery systems we can use. And I congratulate Dr. Jha. I was not thinking that such paper will be coming here, though personally, I am obliged to you that I listened to you and listened. I also learned many things. And though we have, as a medical scientist, we have many observations, but actually this all sciences are one. And when the biological science as a whole and as an applied geology student be, as a student of medicine, as a worker, as a teacher, as a doctor, we feel that if such technologies have come to our help, probably we will serve human better way. And tomorrow we can have some drug against COVID also using this technology, though it is not known, but it can be expanded to it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
I am teaching at Bareilly in UP. And I am also thankful to the organizers of this college, so who are organizing such wide range of topics, like from education, I entered here, then in the history, and then now I am listening. I have listened on the nanotechnology. Congratulations to all organizers as well as speakers. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Jha. Dr. Thakur. Thank you, Dr. Thakur. Sir, B.S. Kumar, he is asking, what are plants used for cancer?
There are many. There are many.
Hello, Anal sir.
Sawal.
Yes, there is some other question also.
Most welcome.
Sir, you can tell us some reference books for students. I think he is talking in respect of nanotechnology or nanoscience books. Sir, you can tell us some reference books for students.
I think Professor Prashad will be suitable person for that.
Yes.
Well, I'll whenever I will suggest, it will be bio nano. Okay, so these are the things. Reference book is definitely our book, which has got published from Springer in 2018. And
okay, you can ask to Dr. Prasad on his mail.
Yes, yes, that's
shared his mail.
Most suitable. Yes. I'm more of a worker than a teacher.
Yes, sir, I want to intervene here.
Yes, yes, Dr. Prasad, sir.
Basically, say, you have to decide which type of topic we want to learn from nanotechnology side, whether you are interested in synthesis part, physical synthesis, chemical synthesis, biological synthesis, or you are interested in knowing the fundamental and science behind nanotechnology, or you are interested in making devices out of it. So there are vast topics. So you have to decide which topic. Accordingly, you write to me. I will suggest the book. Certainly. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Another person, Chandan Thakur, he is asking, sir, there is any treatment for COVID-19 in nanoscience?
Of course, there is, but you know, it is under clinical trial at the moment without permission of Professor.
Oh, sorry. Anal sir, you have been muted. Please unmute yourself. Anal sir. Please unmute yourself. Anal sir.
Yes, yes. Now I can.
Yes, yes.
You can listen me to me.
Yes, yes.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
No, right. So problem is that it's not a big deal in nanoscience and technology. This is not our arrogance. This is our confidence. the thing is, the virus is, again, Anshuji, try to understand. Virus is a micro-nano interface, right? And virus, COVID, so it is congener. Jisko hum log gotiya bolte hain. It is gotiya of influenza virus, HIV, right? It mixoviridae, right? So in every case, it will have a lipoproteinous outer wall, right? And then it has got an RNA inside, which is causing problems. So if you address the boundary, you dismantle the boundary, it will disappear. Or you get inside and destroy the genetic material. This is very tough, very, very tough, because it changes its shape. It is pleomorphic.
आपको अभी पैंट शर्ट में दिख रहा हूं मैं, तो फिर कुर्ता पजामा में आ जाऊंगा, फिर कुर्ता पजामा के बाद मैं दूसरा कपड़ा पहन लूंगा। दिस इज कॉल्ड प्लियोमॉर्फिक। तो इम्यून सेल्स हमेशा इसमें कंफ्यूज होते रहते हैं, ऐसा होता नहीं। मगर हाँ, कुछ ऐसी चीजें हैं जो हमने, कमल भाई ने डेवलप करी है, क्लिनिकल ट्रायल में गया हुआ है, मगर बाबा ने जो कर दिया, रामदेव बाबा ने, उसी डर से हम लोग कुछ कर नहीं रहे। अच्छा, यही क्लिनिकल ट्रायल में है, दो बैच मेडिसिन वहां है, वो लोग डर के मारे हाथ ही नहीं लगा रहा है उसको, बाबा वाले कांड के बाद, समझे ना। ये है, ऐसा कुछ नहीं है। ऑल वी नीड टू डू इज टू प्रॉपर पर्सपेक्टिव ऑफ अ प्रॉब्लम एंड देन यू perceive the problem and then you proceed. That's the part.
Thank you, sir.
नहीं, ये ठीक है, कोई
डॉक्टर ठाकुर
भी चीज randomized controlled trial के बाद ही आनी चाहिए, और जैसा मैंने कहा था, I expected that भी आपका काम इस पर will get a reply, और जो भी चीज हो वो साइंटिफिकली आनी चाहिए, बाबा की बात नहीं, रैंडमाइज्ड कंट्रोल ट्रायल के थ्रू आएगी, और वो आएगी, टाइम लगेगा थोड़ा, आएगी, एंड वी आर डूइंग गुड इन दिस कंट्री। फेथ नहीं किया जाए, फेथ होने के लिए जरूरी है कि आरसीटी के थ्रू को आयुर्वेद के फिर।
थैंक यू सर, नैनो साइंस एंड नैनो टेक्नोलॉजी इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ लिविंग थिंग्स लाइक माइक्रोब्स एंड प्लांट्स। यू डिफाइंड बायो नैनो साइंस एंड नैनो टेक्नोलॉजी इन वेरी कन्विंसिंग वे। यू talked about nanomaterials from kitchen wastes. You also talked about contribution of animals in respect of this. You also talked that life and nano are interrelated. And in the last, you talked about some unresolved issues and challenges. So I think it was very fruitful talk. So thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now, at the end, I would like to invite Dr. Muhammad Mojahidul Islam Saab. He is the head department of history, KMB College Parbatta, and also member of organizing committee, to present the vote of thanks. Dr. M. Islam Saab.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. Ansu Saheb. I, Dr. Muhammad Mojahidul Islam, on the behalf of the KMB College Parbatta and its webinar committee, extend thanks to our chief patron and vice chancellor of Munger University, Munger, Dr. Ranjit Kumar Verma. He blessed us and he attended the seminars. In all seminars, he spoke about the benefits of the webinar. In the seminar, he spoke how the nanotechnology and nanoscience will help in different way. I think we are very much blessed when he wished us success of our webinar. Now, I also extend my thanks to Dr. Kamal Prasad, Department of Physics. He also spoke about why nanoscience has greatly. I hope participants who have joined from the North India, South India, East India, West India, and professors and researchers in science department will get be benefited. I also hope his lectures will help in scientific development. I also extend my thanks to Dr. Anil Khan Jha, Department of Chemistry, Ilka Maji Bhagalpur University, Bhagalpur. I hope his lecture will help the scientists, researchers, and participants in different ways. I also extend my thanks to Dr. K.K. Bhargav, KDS College, Department of Physics. He spoke well about the nanoscience and technology. At last, one word I would like to say, that this webinar will help the Indian scientists, Indian participants, Indian researchers to make the India a global power. And also, once again, India will shine. I also want to say one word for Anshu Kumar Rai, who thought about this topic. I think those countries who will do better discovery and invention in this way will lead the world. I am very much sure Anshu Kumar Rai and all scientists in India will discover and make inventions and will make the India shining, and India once again will lead the world and become the world leader. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. In fact, I am very much thankful to professor and scientist like Dr. Kamal Prasad and Dr. Anil Kant Jha sir, and also to Dr. Bhargav sir, who have accepted our invitation. So, sir, we are very much thankful and grateful to you. And now it is, we are moving towards end of the webinar. So now with the permission of our chairperson of this webinar, sir, I'd like to end the webinar. Do you want to say something, sir? Come on, sir. Okay, so.
No, it was nice to meet you all. Very good. Times and again.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Anil, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, Bhargav, sir. Bhargav, sir, thank you very much. Now, with the permission of kind permission of our principal and chairperson of webinar, I am ending this webinar. So now you can leave. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Bye. Bye.
Bye, sir. Thank you.